ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Shreveport, Louisiana rests on the banks of the Red River in northwest Louisiana. Just 5.5 hours down Interstate 20 come Nick Saban and the Alabama Crimson Tide, hoping to pay off on a season that held so much promise just a couple of months ago. Today, Saban's crew takes on Cody Hawkins, a precocious talent for the Colorado Buffaloes. This year, the Buffalo fans just happy about the fact that they're reveling in the glow, the bask of a bowl game. It's Colorado and Alabama coming up next. And welcome everyone to the Petro Sun Independence Bowl from Independence Stadium here. Alabama taking on Colorado. It's the third meeting all time between these two teams, and the Alabama Crimson Tide playing in this game for the second time in as many seasons. Hello everybody, I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davies. Stacy Dale's joining us in just a short few moments. From all of us at ESPN to all of you at home, all the best in 2008. Hope you had a great, great Christmas. Bob, when you look at this city, ironically, Shreveport, quickly becoming the Hollywood capital of the South with all the movie making going on, a couple of teams today looking for a, well, Hollywood ending to their season.
Well, Mark, these teams are so similar. Both of them 6-6 overall, both of them 4-4 in the conference, and both of them really, really need a win. The bottom line, when this game's over tonight, one team's going to have a winning season. One team's going to have a losing season, and trust me, that is great motivation for these players and these coaches.
When you talk about Colorado, coaches, program, everybody from top to bottom, a lot of upheaval during the last couple of years, but they've settled now on an interesting father-son combination, Dan Hawkins and Cody Hawkins, to build their foundation on.
Well, Mark, in college football, the two most visible and controversial positions are the quarterback and the head coach. Can you imagine the pressure on young Cody Hawkins? Here he is, the starting quarterback at Colorado, only a freshman, and that's not enough. His dad's the head coach. Both of these guys have done a great job. CUU's improved from 2-10 to 6-6, and Cody Hawkins has improved all year. Mark, he's only thrown one interception in the last four football games.
All that after a very rough start, and here come the Buffaloes. Boyd with a little bit of confidence. In their last regular season game against Nebraska, they put a lot of points on the scoreboard. Buffaloes coming in even up at 6-6. Meanwhile, their opponents tonight, hey, what about them? Alabama from just 5.5 hours down Interstate 20. Nick Saban, their head coach, his hiring was voted the story of the year in the state of Alabama. Every coach that comes down the pipe into Alabama ultimately compared with Paul Bear Bryant. I guess that's what happens with Nick Saban now.
Well, Mark, there's no question. Nick Saban is the face of this Alabama football program. And I guess when you pay a guy $4 million a year, people expect some magic. When Alabama started out 6-2, it looked like they had a little magic, but they've lost the last four games. Wins and losses aren't the most important thing for Nick Saban this year at Alabama. It's about building a foundation, Mark, and I think he has built a strong foundation for the future. This is a young, talented Alabama football team.
They've had to deal with a lot of adversity this year. They haven't won a football game since October the 20th against Tennessee. And for more, let's go downstairs to Stacy Dales.
Well, Mark and Bob, one of the biggest reasons that Alabama has struggled of late, besides some injuries and suspensions to the offensive line, is that its quarterback, John Parker Wilson, has struggled himself of late. And offensive coordinator Major Applewhite told us this week that they've really tried to instill some confidence in their quarterback. He's been a bit fragile since the Mississippi State loss 3 games ago. And the biggest area of concern, third down pass efficiency. He is, in fact, second to last in that category in the country. And I talked to John Parker this week. He said, hey, seems like all we've done in practice is work out third down pass efficiency and third down conversions. He said he feels great, very confident, and this is a good chemistry group right now, but he's expecting to start with a clean slate here tonight, Mark.
All right, thanks a lot, Stacy. Yes, the Alabama Crimson Tide coming off a rather disconcerting and deflating loss against Auburn in the Iron Bowl. And here they come onto the field, led by Nick Saban, his first bowl game as head coach of the Crimson Tide. This telecast is available in phenomenal high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Kuro. Under the lights here at Independence Stadium, Alabama taking on Colorado. The third meeting all time between these two teams. A couple of teams coming in at 6-6 overall. And that one victory will really define the type of season that these two teams have had respectively. Nick Saban in his first season as head coach on the sidelines for Alabama. Meanwhile, Dan Hawkins in his second season. Last year they went 2-10. This year started off pretty well, 4-2, and then slumped at 2-4 in the second half.
Well, Mark, there's 7-6-6 teams playing in bowl games this year, and I promise you, in each one of those games, there's a huge difference between winning and losing, because just end with a winning season.
Alabama winning the toss, deferring, actually receiving here, and that's Javier Arenas back after a leg injury in their last game against Auburn. He's a big part of what they do in special teams. Takes it out to the 33-yard line. Here's a look at the sequence of events for Alabama this season. Had a big win against Arkansas earlier in the season and then lost to Georgia in overtime. That seemed to take a little bit of steam out of their collective sails. Came back and won against Tennessee on October the 20th. And, folks, they haven't won a football game since. In over 2 months, still looking for their first win. And then the 7-point loss at Auburn, the sixth consecutive time they've lost to their rivals from across the state. First down and 10 for the Crimson Tide. Glenn Coffey in a tailback. Here's Coffey trying the right side. Finds a nice seam. Got about 7 in the Spurs. Robert Ori, a Bama grad, breaks down the Crimson Tide offense presented by Yellow Book.
The helm of the Tide's offense is big-time playmaker John Parker Wilson. He's the school's all-time leader with 15 career 200-yard passing games. Another big-time baller, receiver DJ Hall, needs one touchdown reception to become Bama's all-time leader. At 340 pounds, first-team All-SEC tackle Andre Smith is virtually unmovable. Let's roll, Tide.
Robert, we agree. 340 pretty much is defining unmovable. Big piece up front. Parker Wilson completes that pass. That's Coffey coming out of the backfield and picks up the first down of the game for Alabama. Let's take a look at Chauncey Billups of the Pistons introducing the Colorado Buffaloes defense.
Defense is the key to winning. Being a two-time NBA defensive player, I should know that. On the front line is a tough group led by George Hippolyte. Inside linebacker Jordan Dizon is the Big 12 Player of the Year. And the secondary features cornerback Terrence Wheatley. Let's go, Buffs.
Former great backcourt starter for the Colorado Buffaloes back in the day, Chauncey Billups. This is Coffey again. Same play, Bob, as that first one. And another good result for the Crimson Tide. Got a good block on the edge from the receiver, Nikita Stover, to pick up 11 yards.
Yeah, Mark, and Glenn Coffey gets the start tonight. Terry Grant, the freshman, been beat up late in the season, out really with a sports hernia. And that time you see just the zone and setting up the zone to side play maybe with John Parker Wilson, the quarterback, keeping that ball.
Coffey out of Fort Walton Beach, Florida. Gets another first down for Alabama after a pretty good start here in the first few plays of the game. McCall in motion. And John Parker Wilson pulls the trigger complete once again to his tight end, Nick Walker. And Walker has another Alabama first down. That time they got 13 yards.
Yeah, Mark, I think confidence for this Alabama offense early in this football game, particularly for John Parker Wilson, is so critical. I mean, they have struggled late in the season. Only 225 yards against Auburn in their last game, 254 against LSU, 274 against Mississippi State. So that's three of the last four games of the season they have not had over 300 yards of total offense.
Stacy talked about getting him a little bit of confidence, Parker Wilson, John Parker Wilson. He hands it off this time to Coffey, who got a couple of yards. And you saw the statistics of their quarterback. Just 15 touchdown passes on the season against 11 interceptions. Bob, you intimated that this year they've really thrown the ball a little bit more than they usually do.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, by Alabama standards, I mean, they've thrown a school record amount of pass attempts, 440 coming into this game, but it was obvious they wanted to run the ball more against Auburn. I think the fact that now they have all their offensive linemen back, they can probably do either, because pass protection was really a problem late in the season.
Yeah, various factors affected the guys up front. Going to run it again, and Coffey again, this time gets a couple of yards. Coffey got about three on the play. Picked up 473 rushing the ball on the season. Started two games.
Mark, here's where Alabama has really struggled on third downs. I mean, they're only 37% of picking up third down. That makes them 80th in the country. And John Parker Wilson has really struggled on third down throwing the football.
Third down and about five to go. Into traffic, and it's incomplete at the 20-yard line. Stover couldn't hang on to it. And it's fourth and five coming up, and on trots the field goal unit led by Lee Tiffin. So they move it downfield and couldn't convert on third down, and Tiffin will attempt this field goal. He's 22 of 31 on the season.
How about his dad, an All-American kicker at Bama? So there's some good genes, Mark, in that family.
Well, Van was an All-American kicker for Ray Perkins back in the day. This one coming from about 41 yards out. And Tiffin will give Alabama the first points of the ball game. They lead 3-0. So an auspicious beginning for the Crimson Tide, shaking out those cobwebs from their last game. Back after this.
NASN's live coverage of every BCS Bowl continues this Thursday with the Orange Bowl. Virginia Tech brings its two-quarterback system to Miami to face one of the biggest surprises of the season in the number 8-ranked Kansas Jayhawks. The Orange Bowl live, Virginia Tech versus Kansas, this Thursday only on NASN.
What do I control? I don't control the bumps and the bruises, the crowd, or who covers me. I don't control the bounces, the shootout order, or for that matter, what happens outside the rink. There are a lot of things in life I don't control. But then again, there are some things that I do.
If you can help someone else to live, then I think it's a really, really worthwhile thing to do.
Basically, to help other people.
If the organs can be given to somebody else who can benefit from them, then it's very important.
If I've got half a part of my body that someone else can use when I'm dead, why not?
If I'm dead, that's it, I ain't gonna need them.
It's about kind of allowing people to have a better quality of life after you're dead.
Basically, you're saving someone's life. And if you was in the same situation, you'd want someone else to do the same thing for you as well.
Tradition. Pride. Teamwork. Spirit.
He's something. 25-20, and he scores!
Tigers win!
Holy cow!
Heartbreak. Glory. NCAA College Football on NASN.
Back at Independence Stadium in Shreveport, Louisiana, Lee Tiffin with a field goal from 41 yards out a few moments ago, in the process setting a new Alabama season record for points for a kicker. Back deep for the Buffaloes now, it's Charles and Ellis. And this is going to be Hugh Charles. And Charles stopped up right around the 20-yard line. And boy, for Colorado, been an interesting tale of almost two seasons. They win their opener against Colorado State, their in-state rival. Beat Oklahoma, who was ranked number 3 at the time. That really buoyed their confidence, and then lost to Kansas in a tight game. And then in the second half of the season, they went 2-4 before finally beating Nebraska on their last regular season game, putting up 65 points in the process. And Dan Hawkins' team, after a 2-10 season last year, this year included in the big bowl party.
Mark, that Nebraska win was huge because the Buffaloes had lost 4 of 5 before beating Nebraska in Boulder.
First down and 10 for the Buffaloes. Hawkins with a play fake. And he's picked off. Number 25, Rolando McClain, with the first turnover of the ball game on the first offensive play for Alabama. A 6'4 talented freshman who was all SEC this year, and it appeared like Hawkins didn't even see him. That's his second interception of the season. Hawkins hit him right in the numbers.
And Hawkins had only thrown one interception, Mark, in the last four football games. But I want you to watch right here. This is only a freshman, but they have one receiver behind him, one in front. But Rolando does not suck up on the short one, drops underneath in zone coverage, comes up with a huge interception here early in the football game. Rolando McClain, just a freshman linebacker.
One of the best-looking athletes we saw on the field yesterday during their walkthrough. First down and 10 for Alabama from the 15 of Colorado. Coffey picks up a couple of yards. Brandon Nicholas making the stop up front for the Buffaloes.
Marky, go back to that interception by Cody Hawkins. He had thrown 14 interceptions in the first 8 games. He was on track to break the school record for interceptions, but as I mentioned, only one interception in the last 4 games.
His father, proud of the way that he's handled some of the adversity, so a little early adversity in this ball game for Hawkins, a redshirt freshman. Second down and about 8 to go for the Crimson Tide, lining up out of the eye. They're going to try and pound Coffey again between the tackles. That time maybe got 2 more. Sets up a 3rd and about 6 to go. Jeff Smart making the stop for the Buffaloes. Major Applewhite is the offensive coordinator for the Alabama Crimson Tide at 29 years old, the youngest coordinator in the country.
Well, he's looking down. 2 things, being the offensive coordinator for Nick Saban and being the offensive coordinator at Alabama. He's probably aged a little bit over this past year. So 29 is a good number, yeah. But he probably has a few more miles on him now, Mark. Yeah,
closer to 35 right now with 10 minutes to go here in the first period. Alabama trying to be opportunistic after the turnover. John Parker Wilson complete to Coffey, who's about 2 yards short of the first down.
And you know these Alabama fans want Nick Saban to go for it on 4th down. He's going to go ahead and kick the field goal. I'm a little bit surprised because he has this entire offensive line back now intact, but probably a good decision. Go ahead and get the points right here.
It's an offensive line that's really going to have to protect John Parker Wilson throughout the night. Right now, though, the task providing a little protection for Lee Tiffin. This field goal much shorter, this one from 24 yards out. And he knocks it through to make it 6-0 for Alabama.
Mark, that really is a win for the Colorado defense after that turnover and the interception by Rolando McClain.
An education in anticipation by McClain gave his team good field position. It resulted in a field goal. Back after this. One of the more indelible images in college football, Ralphie just he took a chill pill before this game. He's the Ralphie the Fourth, the current female massive Colorado Buffalo mascot who leads the team onto the field at the beginning of the game and at the start of the third quarter as well. The kick goes out of bounds. Nick Saban, the face of this Alabama team, but you go back to 1990, he was in Toledo, Ohio, then on to Michigan State. His next head coaching position, LSU, reaped a national championship some 4 seasons ago, then a stint with the pros and a very contentious departure from Miami onto the sidelines in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. 6-6 coming into this game.
You know what, Major Applewhite, we showed him a little bit ago. Mark, he probably said it best about Nick Saban. We asked him the experience of coaching for Nick Saban this year. He said, every day, every minute, it's like 4th and 1. So there's no question Nick Saban brings an intensity to this football team.
Byron Ellis now in a tailback for Colorado. Now they empty out the formation. Sprague in motion. That's that little pop play they like to run. That's going to be a 1st down. Dusty Sprague.
And Mark, you are going to see that all night long. The wide receiver motion, then reverse or fake reverse. Right here you see Dusty Sprague, and it ends up being really a 3-back offense. And it's amazing. If you watched Oregon State the other night in the Emerald Bowl, they must have ran that thing 20 or 25 times in the game. But you're going to see a lot of that tonight for Colorado.
That's still pretty much the vogue play in college football now, isn't it?
Well, one of. Actually, Wake Forest started it, but it's making its way west now. There it is again.
This time they fake off of it and out of the backfield, incomplete, intended for Hugh Charles. Well, Chauncey Billups, the 2004 Pistons NBA champion, introducing the Buffalo's offense, presented by Yellow Book.
Buffalo's passing attack is led by true freshman Cody Hawkins. Running back Hugh Charles seeks his 700-yard rushing game. On the O-line, senior Tyler Palumbus has not only played in each game, but has played on every snap. Let's go, Buffs, baby.
Chauncey got a little juiced on the offense.
Yeah, two freshmen, Mark, starting on that offensive line from Colorado. Unheard of, really, in major college football.
Right now, trying to keep their quarterback upright. They hand it off to Hugh Charles, and Charles is stopped up. He got jacked up right near midfield at the 47-yard line by Prince Hall. A royal hit that time by Prince.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, Prince Hall was the starter early in the season. Watch him step up right here. I mean, that is a textbook tackle. I mean, Hugh Charles is a strong guy. I mean, he flipped him on his back right there.
Pound for pound, Charles is the strongest guy in that Colorado team. So what does that say about the strength of Prince Hall? It'll be third down and eight coming up right around midfield for Colorado.
And we talked about Alabama struggling on third down, Mark. Colorado, number 100 in the NCAA in third down conversion.
Hawkins completes the pass that time to his tight end, Tyson DeVray. But he's 2 yards short of the first down. This is a team that likes to go for it on fourth down. But this time, it appears that Coach Dan Hawkins is going to send on the punting unit.
Well, Mark, you talk about it. They're number five in the nation of teams going for it on fourth down 26 times. But the top four teams, Notre Dame, North Texas, Idaho, New Mexico State, what do you notice about those four teams?
Not much success.
All losing records. The top four that went for it on fourth down. But
they're going to fake it here, Bob. And they run the end-around play. And they get down to the 44-yard line, and it's short of the first down. Byron Ellis took the carry, but Alabama was waiting on it.
Well, Mark, that makes 27 times that Dan Hawkins has gone for it on fourth down. And right here, you're going to see the center on the direct snap to Byron Nelson. Little fumble Ruski type play, but great discipline out there by number 21, Prince Hall. Staying at home.
Ellis tried to sell the fake. He really froze there, but the Alabama guys were just looking him in the eye and saying, hey, we know you got that football.
Mark, that was great discipline by Prince Hall right there to stay at home. That was a pretty good fake, man.
Roy Upchurch is in a tailback now for Alabama. He's the second of the three guys that we could potentially see tonight. John Parker Wilson completes this pass for first down, and that's Upchurch out of the backfield, who picks up a first down for Alabama. Upchurch, Coffee, Terry Grant, the freshman, is the guy next in line.
And Mark, not to belabor it, but you take the top four teams that went for it on fourth down, all losing record, and there's no question, when you go it on fourth down, you challenge the opponent. And right now, Alabama won that challenge, and they have all the momentum in this football game. Sometimes it's not bad to just punt it, man,
yeah.
Right?
It's Upchurch keeping it, faking the end around. And he's brought down for a loss back at the 41-yard line. Ryan Walters, the starting free safety, the 5'11 junior, making the stop on the play. One of the leaders back there for Colorado defensively. Second down and 13 coming up for Alabama.
Mark, that was a great job by Ryan Walters. Watch him right here. He comes on the blitz. Then he redirects out there and keeps containment on the football. Ryan Walters, his dad actually played quarterback for Bill McCartney at Colorado.
Grew up in the apartments on campus. Glenn Coffey back in the ballgame for the Crimson Tide in the backfield. John Parker Wilson going to keep it himself. And Wilson has a little bit of mobility. All the way inside the 20 down to the 17-yard line. First down, Alabama. He owns seven school passing and total offense records, but nobody said he could run like that.
Well, Mark, I think that was a quarterback run all the way. If you watch the offensive linemen, they end up downfield. You look right here, number 50, Britt, is releasing downfield. So that was a predetermined quarterback run right there by John Parker Wilson. I mean, that was a cavern that opened up in the middle of that football field.
Picked up 24 yards down to the 17-yard line. Little counterplay, Coffey. Makes it down to the 15. Coffey had a big game earlier this year at 30 carries for 121 yards against Houston. And he was also Alabama's leading rusher earlier this year against Georgia in that very tight, kind of deflating loss so far in this game. Seven rushes for a total of 30 yards. Sets up second down and an eight.
And not a real dynamic, flashy running back, Glenn Coffey, but a good, solid, steady guy.
From the 15-yard line, John Parker Wilson given plenty of time. He can pick and choose and chooses to throw it out the back of the end zone. It'll be third down and long coming up now for Alabama. Nobody to find open in the end zone. Wisely throws it away, and so far, Bob, conspicuous by his absence, we haven't heard much from DJ Hall, the team's leading receiver and big play threat.
Well, Mark, right now they've been ahead of the chains a little bit, been able to run the football, have had great field position. But just going back to that decision by John Parker Wilson right there, not a bad decision. I mean, he's a guy that struggled with interceptions late in the season. But again, this sets up a big third down, and this guy is next to last in college football in third down passing efficiency for a quarterback.
Well, Stacy Dales reported at the top of the show that during University the bowl practice sessions, they've been able to hold. They worked a lot
this will also be
on
a media
red zone offense, particularly trying to get Wilson a little bit of confidence, trying to get him back to where he could be productive on third down. Back with third down.
NHL continues on NASN with a live Hockey Night in Canada doubleheader. Danny Briere and Philadelphia fly into Toronto to face the Maple Leafs. Then in an interconference showdown, the Rangers lay down the law in Edmonton. A live Hockey Night in Canada doubleheader this Saturday only on NASN.
And 3 years of law school teach you a lot. For him, it's confidence. For me, it's pride. Go to NCAAstudent.org to find out how your child could become one of the many student athletes who go pro in something other than sports.
Coverage of the BCS begins New Year's Day with a live back-to-back doubleheader of the Rose and the Sugar Bowl. Number 6-ranked USC make their third straight trip to Pasadena, where they will face the surprise BCS pick Illinois in the granddaddy of them all, the Rose Bowl. Then the Sugar Bowl takes center stage as 12-0 Hawaii face Georgia and their legions of Bulldog fans. A live BCS doubleheader New Year's Day only on NASN.
All right, thanks a lot, Reese. 6-0 for the Crimson Tide, and a crucial third down coming up in scoring position on the 15-yard line, 3rd and 8 to go. Wilson out of the shotgun, gets a little bit of heat. Touchdown! Keith Brown! Well, that's pretty good conversion on third down. Doesn't get much better than that. And Alabama with the game's first touchdown.
Mark, it doesn't get much easier than that. Keith Brown right here is going to run right up that seam, untouched, and split the two safeties right there. They roll to a three-deep coverage, and he just split the corner and the safety. That was too easy, wasn't it?
Certainly was. Keith Brown, Bob, one of 14 Alabama seniors playing in their final game. Wilson throws a rope to Brown. In the past, he's been kind of his own worst enemy. Not on that play, though. Back with more after this. Keith Brown's fifth touchdown of the season makes it 13-0. Bob, why did this play work?
Well, Mark, Colorado tries to disguise this coverage. They roll this safety to the outside third. They take this safety and they try to get him to the middle third, but they leave Keith Brown unmolested right down the field. And there's just no way that backside safety can get over the top of that with an unmolested receiver running right down and splitting those two guys.
Here's the kick and back deep. It's Ellis and Charles. It's going to be Charles again. Charles looking to get to the edge, has pretty good speed. But you know what? So does the SEC en masse. And let's go downstairs to Stacey Dale. Stacey?
Well, guys, we can see early that Alabama is a very congruent team. They're playing with a lot of chemistry. And one thing the coaches did after that four-game slide at the end of the regular season, they went back and took the spring game from preseason and showed the team. And defensive coordinator Kevin Steele said it was like a Chinese fire drill. They couldn't recognize the team. I talked to some players, and they said it didn't even look like we were practicing. It looked like more of a pickup basketball game. But what they did is they went back and they looked at Auburn and looked at Tennessee. They took some plays out of those games, guys, plays that weren't executed in that preseason game, and they showed this team, hey, yeah, we have come a long way, even though we're 6-6, Mark.
Yes, 6-6 with some asterisks beside those losses, because a lot of them were very close. Here's Hugh Charles, initially stopped up at the line of scrimmage, falling forward to pick up about two on the play, and stopped up there by Keith Saunders, number 94. Well, Robert Horry, once again, an Alabama native with the Crimson Tide defense.
As a seven-time NBA champion, trust me when I say key to winning is defense. And making big plays and up front, Wallace Gilbert will make some big plays. Seniors Darren Musson and Keith Sanders are among a talented group of linebackers. Lockdown cornerback Simeon Castile is looking to add to his 12 career interceptions. And last but not least, Roll Tide Roll.
You got to listen to a dude that's got seven championship rings. Colorado mishandling the play once again. Hawkins is down at the 30-yard line. Things imploding for the Buffaloes here early in the ballgame, Bob.
Well, Mark, there's no question. If they're not careful, I mean, this game can get out of hand right now. But just talking about this Alabama defense, we look at Dan Hawkins. I mean, this is a self-inflicted mistake again by Colorado. But Alabama has played good defense, Mark, all year long. They come in here 28th in the nation in total defense. And I think the best thing Nick Saban does, he adjusts to what offenses do. He's not afraid to tweak that game plan every week, particularly coverage-wise, to take away the offense's best routes.
See what they got here on third down. Hawkins, Ellis makes the catch, but it's jarred loose once again. Rolando McClain, the all-SEC selection, jarred the ball loose, and that's the second pivotal play he's made just here early in the ballgame. Had the interception moments ago. Three and out for the Colorado offense.
Hey, that is a great-looking true freshman linebacker right there. I mean, and in Nick Saban's defense, that linebacker, a lot of times he'll call a defense, and there are three potential checks for the linebacker. And Rolando McClain has done a tremendous job with that as well.
And Delalo, the left-footed punter for the Buffaloes, gets a high one off, which bounces, takes a good roll for the Buffaloes inside the 40. As we go to Reese Davis in the studio for a SportsCenter 30-30 update.
All right, Mark, still trying to clear up the playoff picture in the NFL. In the NFC, the Washington Redskins are going to the postseason. They beat the Cowboys 27-6. Clinton Portis having a big day, scored a couple of touchdowns. They'll get the Seahawks on Saturday. In the AFC, if the Titans beat the Colts, they're in. Chris Brown, former Buffalo, scoring a touchdown. 7-0 Titans halfway through the first. SportsCenter after the game. Stay current, ESPN News.
All right, you got it, Reese. 3:15 to go in the first quarter.
Mark, I think it's important Alabama gets DJ Hall in this game here.
There's Upchurch on the sweep, and he got a nice gain of about 7 yards. And, yeah, you talked about it. DJ Hall is the home run hitter offensively for Alabama. Set several school receiving records this year, including single-season yardage. Good size at 6'2 and good speed as well.
Well, what happens to Mark, he's like a lot of great players. If he doesn't get involved early, he gets a little bored, gets a little frustrated. So, you know what, it's going good right now, but get DJ Hall involved. You know, he struggled against Auburn, only had 3 catches.
Second down and 3. Stover in motion. They run it to Upchurch. Stays on his feet and picked up the first down into Colorado territory at the 49-yard line. Upchurch picked up 7 on that play.
And Mark, that's a great run by Upchurch. Watch right here. Colorado has an opportunity right there to tackle him behind the line of scrimmage. Terrence Wheatley, the corner up in there. But Upchurch taking advantage of his carries. He's fought shoulder and ankle injuries this year as well.
Yeah, because of those injuries, Bob, he missed the Vandy and the Louisiana Monroe. That surely is a sore spot still that festers with some of the Alabama fans. Wilson with the play fake underneath, the pass complete to Stover. And I mentioned the UL Monroe game, Bob. That is a burr in their collective saddles right now. They lost to Louisiana Monroe several weeks ago, and that really set off a sequence of unfortunate events and comments for the program. November 17th, Wilson throwing 2 interceptions, and Louisiana Monroe forced 4 turnovers, blocked a field goal, and turned Alabama away 3 times on promising drives. Frank Gooden had a 13-yard touchdown run, and the result was the Tide's 3rd consecutive loss. The 24.5-point underdog, Louisiana Monroe, beat Nick Saban and the Tide 21-14.
Well, to make matters worse, all those Alabama fans driving over here on I-20 had to drive through Monroe to get here. And I understand there's a big billboard right off of I-20. But
what's it say? What do you think it says?
I know it was positive for UL Monroe. But, you know, Alabama outgained them, Mark, 409 to 282 yards. But that doesn't matter. You just cannot hide from the fact that UL Monroe and Charlie Weatherby came into Tuscaloosa and beat Alabama. It's hard to live that one down.
Approaching 2 minutes to go here in the first quarter. It has been all Crimson Tide, and DJ Hall gets his first touch of the ball game. It's completed the 34-yard line. Ironically, DJ Hall almost chose LSU coming out of high school after Saban won a national title there.
Yeah, Mark, he's from Fort Walton Beach, Florida. They move him around a lot, but how about the pass protection? Excellent right here by Alabama. Look right here at that window to throw the football through for John Parker Wilson. That was great protection.
Smith, Britt, Caldwell, Johnson up front. Caldwell. First down and 10 once again for the Crimson Tide. Wilson going up top. Has a man. What a grab by Stover. Cardell got it too. Matt Cadell with another big catch. He's done it so many times this year. And Cadell gives Alabama a 19-0 lead.
Mark, Terrence Wheatley, Colorado's best corner, has excellent coverage right here. But just a little burst by Cadell right there. Remember, he's the one that had the game winner against Arkansas. Well-thrown football. I mean, he got that football out in front where Cadell could use his speed and acceleration to beat Terrence Wheatley.
That's his 2nd touchdown reception of the season. As you mentioned, Bob, his other one was a game winner against Arkansas late in that contest. The 5th of his career, and Alabama comes out of the gate smoking at 20-0 with 1:31 to go now in the first period of play. And for more on Cadell, let's go downstairs to Stacy.
Mark and Bob, if you recall this week when we were on the call with offensive coordinator for Alabama, Major Applewhite, he made a point of telling us Matt Cadell is the most stable player, one of the most that I've ever been around. He is a joy to be around. He comes to practice. He finishes practice every single day. And there's really, guys, not a guy I'd rather be around than Matt Cadell. He's performing tonight, Mark.
Mark, how about this? This guy had 12 punt returns as a senior in high school. That's still the national record, but he has been in the shadows a little bit because of DJ Hall, Mike McCoy, Nikita Stover, Keith Brown. But just as Stacy said, I mean, Major Applewhite could not say enough about this guy.
And he gives Alabama a 20-0 lead. Boy, Colorado has to do something to get a little bit of momentum going. It started off inauspiciously with them on their first offensive series, Bob, when Hawkins threw that interception on the first play of the game for Colorado. Then there was the faked 4th down which didn't go for the first down.
Mark, you see this so many times in bowl games. I mean, some teams get off the super hot starts because there's so many variables in preparation for these games, so many coaching decisions on how to prepare your team to be ready to play.
There's Charles on the kickoff return over the 30 down to the 33-yard line. Well, Capital One Bowl Week features over 20 bowl games in 12 days on the ESPN family and networks, continuing with two afternoon games on New Year's Eve, on the eve of New Year's Eve. First at 12:30 Eastern on ESPN, Cal faces Air Force in the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl. Then at 2 Eastern on ESPN2, Georgia Tech takes on Fresno State in the Rhodes Humanitarian Bowl.
About 9 SEC teams in bowl games, 2 BCS teams, Georgia and LSU. South Carolina bowl eligible at 6-6. Didn't go, Marker. That would have been 10.
What about Mississippi State? What a great story defeating UCF in their bowl game. We got a flag down into play. And Sylvester Broom's Bulldogs winning yesterday, a game you saw on ESPN. Set them at 8-5 on the season.
Mark, I talk about so many variables in bowl preparation for these coaches. You know, during the season, everything's controlled. How many hours you can meet, how many hours you can practice. In the preseason, it's all controlled by how many days you can have contact, how many days in full pads. For bowl game preparation, there are no rules. So there's a huge variable from coaching philosophies on how to prepare a team for these bowl games. So many times you see one team jump out early and then the other team can never catch up. That's happening right now, obviously, to Colorado.
In a big way, here's Ellis on the carry for the Buffaloes. Got about 2 yards on the play. Which way did you like to do it when you were calling the shots, going to bowl games? What did you like to do with your program? Well, was there time off and then a lot of work, or I'd just space it out?
I think you're probably asking the wrong guy. If you go back and look at some of those Notre Dame press guys, we didn't have great success in bowl games. But you take a look at Nick Saban. I mean, he's coached in games like the Sugar Bowl for the national championship. This game here tonight with a 6-6 Alabama team right now to Nick Saban is just as important as that national championship game in the Sugar Bowl at LSU in 2003.
44 seconds to go in the first quarter. Running the game, Hugh Charles between the tackles and hit hard at the 35-yard line. Once again, McClain there along with Kareem Jackson. Gained 5 on the play. Rolando McClain was all freshman SEC this year.
And Mark, you watch what's happening. If we stop that right there, I mean, look, that is really 1, 2, 3 backs in the backfield, and then it's a bit of a misdirection. I mean, that's what's becoming in vogue right now. Kind of a glorified wishbone look right now, but amazing the other night, Oregon State, I'll bet 25 times in that football game.
That originally was a Spurrier thing, wasn't it?
It really was, and then Wake Forest took it to a new level with Jim Grobe.
Well, all the smoke and mirrors aren't working so far for Colorado in the Petrosun Independence Bowl, the 32nd version of it. Alabama leading so far 20-0. We'll be back with the second period right after this. Start of the second quarter here at Independence Stadium. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Stacy Dales. Colorado with the football, looking at third down and about 8 to go. Working from their own 36-yard line. Hawkins under some heat, dumps it off complete. And it's Sprague, and he's upended about 3 yards short of the first down. He got 5 on the play, and that brings up a fourth down. It's 3 bottom.
Mark, that was a great effort by Ezekiel Knight, number 47. He was a wide receiver, and that was a great effort out there in the open field, just closing on that thing.
Fourth down coming up, and Dalalo will punt. Sitting up at his own 27. A lot of pressure, and it might have been partially blocked. It was. Goodell with another big play. This time on special teams for Alabama. It rolls forward down to the 35-yard line, but there's number 11, Goodell once again, who caught a touchdown pass a few moments ago. And Alabama will have pretty good field position at the 35.
Mark, Cadell's going to line up at the top right here. He's the one down in the stance. He's going to start up the field and then come underneath, which is always a cardinal sin right here if you're that slot back. See him let him underneath? And that's the path to that block point. That is a great effort of laying out and getting his hands on that football. But Colorado right now, Mark, they're going to be blown back to Boulder here if they don't get a defensive stop right here.
Yeah, that's the direction that it's heading in. Coffey back in the ballgame at tailback for Alabama. And John Parker Wilson, like the reincarnation of Joe Namath in that first quarter. On the reverse, it's Cadell. They give it to him again, and why not? He has had the Midas touch in this ballgame so far for Alabama. On that play, he picks up 12 more in a first down.
And Mark, you talk about John Parker Wilson. He actually got a block out there on the reverse. But, you know, this game, the way it started, has taken so much pressure off of John Parker Wilson, who struggled late in the season. But how about this guy? Played at Hoover High School in Hoover, Alabama. Then he goes on to Alabama. I mean, his mom was a cheerleader in 1979. I mean, this guy's the perfect Alabama quarterback because of all those things, but a lot of pressure on a young guy like this being the quarterback at Alabama.
Yeah, 79, that was the national championship year, and the 20 points that he helped orchestrate in the first quarter, the most points they've scored in a ball game, in a bowl game, pardon me, going back to the 1953 season.
Mark, he was a starter at Hoover. They won the state championship in 03 and 04. Alabama Player of the Year in 03. So a lot of people just expected him to come out of Alabama and win a national championship right away.
Going up top here, intended in the direction of DJ Hall, incomplete. Well, help decide the Pontiac game-changing performance of the year. Voted ESPN.com and search Pontiac to determine which school will win the $100,000 general scholarship fund contribution courtesy of Pontiac. We talk about Hoover in Alabama, that storied high school football program, Bob. They even got their own special on MTV a couple of times.
You're right.
I channel surf a little bit.
You're
I caught
right.
that.
I watched a little bit of that. That actually was a pretty good program on television. They've had a little controversy since then, but I think in some ways maybe all the attention that Nick Saban has gotten at Alabama maybe he's taken a little pressure off John Parker Wilson.
He is Saban is certainly a lightning rod, both in his actions and what he has said at times. Back with more right after this. Everyone to the Petro Sun Independence Bowl, the 32nd edition of this game. And interesting that the last three editions of this game have been decided by a total of just 17 points. So some close games in the history, the recent history of these matchups. Right now, not so close, although it can still turn out that way. It's been a dominant performance by Alabama, being able to take advantage of turnovers. On the receiver screen, Cadell again has another first down and then some all the way down to the 36-yard line of Colorado. Finally stomped up by Brad Jones, but what an impact Cadell is having on this game. That time he picked up 18.
Mark, he got a great block by the guard right here. Watch him pull out in front of this screen right here. Right there. That is a great lick by number 59, Antoine Caldwell, who started at every position on the offensive line this year.
The offensive line looking stellar so far. They hand it off to Coffey, and Coffey got about 3 yards on the play. Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Stacy Dales here at Liberty Stadium for the Petro Sun Independence Bowl. It's Alabama out of the SEC against Colorado out of the Big 12. The 55th bowl appearance for Alabama, which leads all NCAA schools. The third meeting all time between these two schools. Each team has won one. This is the rubber match. Second down and 6 coming up for the Crimson Tide. Max lineup out of the eye. We have yet to see Terry Grant, the freshman, so far in the game. Wilson under duress and throws it away wisely.
Mark, you talk about how important this game is for Alabama. Last year they had a losing season. It's been 45 years since Alabama has back-to-back losing seasons. I mean, it's been 22 years since Colorado's had back-to-back losing seasons. So for one of these teams, it's going to be a disappointing finish to this season. And trust me, there is a huge difference between 7-6 and 6-7.
It's interesting to look at the respective rebuilding jobs that both these two coaches have undertaken. Rebuilding in Alabama, a little different story than doing the same at Colorado. Third down and 6 for Wilson. He fires complete over the middle, and this is going to be a score. Touchdown! Stover is heads over heels. He was untouched. 31 yards for the score.
Nikita Stover, Mark, goes untouched for a touchdown right here.
And he's flipping out. Literally.
And there was no penalty called on that?
No flag on the play. It's bowl season. The officials may be feeling a little charitable at the time. 12:20 to go in the first half, and it has been all Crimson Tide.
I think Ralphie may be ready to retire at halftime, Mark. You said he's going to retire after this season? I think he may start heading back to Boulder early.
The way things are going, it might be a wise decision. Colorado with a daunting task when we come back.
BCS coverage continues this Wednesday as the party moves to Arizona. The number 4 ranked Sooners return to the Fiesta Bowl after last year's unthinkable defeat to Boise State. But West Virginia will be looking to make amends after just missing out on the national championship game. The Fiesta Bowl live this Wednesday only on NASN.
I'm shooting the bold and the beautiful NFL jerseys from Reebok. Now, stick out that chest.
For Reebok official NFL jerseys and more, visit NASN.com.
Dave's a chain smoker. He thinks he struck lucky with some cheap fags. He got from Mick. One of 20 cartons he got from Tony, who's just finished a stretch for GBH. But he committed while he was working for Frank, who deals in all kinds of dodgy stuff. And is supplied by people who will smuggle anything, do anything, for the price of a cheap packet of fags. Don't be blind to the crime. Call Customs Confidential on 0800 59 5000. Break the chain.
Last night on the banks of the Red River, and there was a distinctive Crimson Tide flavor about town during the last couple of days. On the kickoff, it's going to be Charles again. Somebody looking to make a play for Colorado, and Charles is going to be stopped up at about the 27-yard line. Bob, why did this last touchdown work?
Well, Mark, Colorado gave up 610 yards to Nebraska, 500 passing. But watch these two safeties. They're going to play too deep, but this safety is going to start back outside, and they're going to avoid the middle of this football field right here. It's supposed to be a two-deep coverage, but there's a little bit of confusion by the left safety. And that's just a cavern in between the two safeties. And I can't believe that wasn't called right there for that little.
Maybe he thought he was being chest. You know I have no problem with that.
But Mark, this Colorado defense gave up 598 yards and 55 points to Missouri, 610 yards and 51 points to Nebraska in two of the last three games. And they are reeling tonight in the secondary.
Alabama scored in this last four straight possessions, and Cody Hawkins sitting on his wallet right now has pretty much been a nice snapshot of the way things have gone.
Defense number 97, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
I tell you, if this keeps going, Nick Saban's going to get a pay raise.
An extension?
He's going to sign a new contract tonight in Shreveport before he leaves. He's going to jump a little bit from that $4 million salary he's making, Mark.
Well, that $4 million, the subject of a lot of conversation right now amongst the school presidents and salaries of head coaches across the country, really, Bob, becoming an issue right now.
Mark, nothing personal, but it's crazy
for
a college football coach to be making $4 million a year. And again, nothing personal against Nick, but he had the perfect leverage. If you think back, Alabama had offered the job to Rich Rodriguez. He turned it down. Then they were hung out because they had to hire a big-name coach. So Nick Saban leaves the Miami Dolphins, but still, $4 million a year to coach football in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. That's a little crazy, isn't it?
There are a couple of coaches not that far out of that $4 million neighborhood, so it's not just him either.
Well, I know the market commands it, but things are out of whack now.
Byron Ellis in the backfield, and another whistle down to the field. And
delay. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
Stacy has a little bit more on Coach Saban.
Well, guys, you talk about the salary, and there's no question it's a big salary, but there also isn't a question of how tirelessly this guy works. And I talked to John Parker Wilson, quarterback. I asked him, what is it like to play for Nick Saban? He said, the hardest part is that it's adjusting to the way that you practice every day. He said it is still adjustment, even after a year with Nick Saban. They move constantly in practice. They're ever change. Everything is changing. There's never a dull moment. He said the easiest thing is to buy into it because you really have no choice, Mark.
It can be and has been described as a very dictatorial, authoritarian style of coaching. This is the reverse to Dusty Sprague out of bounds. Got about two on the play. And Saban's departure from South Florida, the Miami Dolphins, can best be characterized as very vitriolic. There still are some rancorous, bitter feelings that exist down there. And
Mark,
they feel they were a little bit deceived. Yeah.
Sure, but I mean, the situation changed. There was a point where Rich Rodriguez was probably going to take that job, and Nick Saban was not going to Alabama. The reality, he and his wife, Terry, love college football. At some point, you have to do what's in your heart. It wouldn't have been fair to the Miami Dolphins if he stayed when his heart was really back in college football. So it was unfortunate the way it worked out, but I know he and his family are happy to be back in college football.
This is Hugh Charles on a nice run, and Charles with a first down for Colorado. Out near midfield at the 50-yard line, Hugh Charles, the 5'8 senior, one of 15 seniors playing their final game for the Buffaloes, picks up 22 yards. This year he had 400-yard rushing games.
Mark, that is a great effort. I mean, right there in the backfield, he makes Ezekiel Knight miss. I mean, that is a one-man effort right there by the senior who both of us have liked for a long time. I think this guy has a bright NFL future. I really do.
Just went over 1,000 yards rushing for the season. A young man that's extremely bright. Some describe him as a little bit offbeat, but then any senior that has his own pilot's license to fly Cessnas certainly is a little bit of an aberration. That time he picks up 5 yards. He's not cruising around campus on scooters.
Well, Mark, they say he's been kind of a workout guy, kind of a track guy. I mean, he's always had great numbers, 4.37 40, benches about 405 pounds, vertical jumps out of the gym. I mean, he's going to test well for the NFL. But what they mean by track mentality, maybe he didn't play as physical in football. He kind of liked working out in the weight room a little more than he liked competing on the practice field. But I think he's had a great senior year.
And recently watched a lot of tape of the late, great Walter Payton on how to deliver a blow on the defender as a running back. That time couldn't hang on to it. Pass a little bit errant by Cody Hawkins that time.
And Wallace Gilberry, number 92, good pressure. I mean, Wallace Gilberry's a guy, Mark, leads the SEC in tackles for losses. also second in the SEC in sacks with 9. Plays with a lot of fire. 3-year starter right here.
His friendship with Chuck Smith, a former NFL All-Pro pass rusher, speaks to him frequently and gets a lot of tips and critiques on his play and performance. Third down and 5 coming up for Colorado. Pass complete, and there's the speed of that Alabama defense. Good closing speed by Lionel Mitchell, the backup corner, made the hit on Stephon Robinson.
Mark, you just said it. I mean, I don't know if Alabama has great speed compared to the other Southeastern Conference teams, but watch this speed right here. Lionel Mitchell, their third corner, a starter in nickel, just closed on that football.
And you know Stephon Robinson can run. We saw his sister earlier today coming from the gym, a track star at the University of Texas with some pretty good wheels. Keep the speed all in the family, the Robinsons do. This time, though, Colorado forced to punt and unable to pin it inside the 10-yard line. It goes 47 yards in all. It'll come out to the 20. It's tough hearing good things when you're down 27-0. Got to clean those ears out. Cody Hawkins may be saying, can you hear me now?
Yeah, Mark.
So far, nobody hearing him offensively. No rhythm, Bob, for Colorado.
16 freshman quarterbacks started in the NCAA this year, Mark. 8 at BCS conference schools. None of them like being behind 27-0. I mean, that's tough because you're going to have to throw the football, obviously, to even climb back in this game.
Hey, but what about, Bob, the guy dealing a hot hand right now? John Parker Wilson, a quarterback for Alabama, has thrown 3 touchdowns in his last 8 passes. And with 8:59 to go in the first half, he has been really in rhythm so far. First down and 10 for Alabama from their own 20. Upchurch with the catch out of the backfield, got about 6. Well, here's tonight's Aflac trivia question.
Aflac.
Who is the only Alabama coach since 1987 to win a bowl game in his first season? Mike Shula, Dennis Franchione, Mike DeBose, or Gene Stallings? To play, text CF to 4ESPN 43776. Standard message rates may apply.
Did you get the Ducks that Aflac sent us as a Christmas gift?
I've been home much.
I probably should have brought that up. You mean you didn't get those?
I didn't. Sore subject now. Yeah. Roy Upchurch on the carry, stopped by Brad Jones.
Mark, John Parker Wilson came into this football game. You know, his confidence was a little bit fragile. But because of turnovers by Colorado, excellent field position, some broken coverages by Colorado, he is rolling right now.
Came into the game completing just 55% of his passes. And that touchdown to interception ratio wasn't all that great, but he's upped his numbers in this game. They lead 27-0. He has been on point that time to DJ Hall for a first down at the 45-yard line. The coverage provided by Terrence Wheatley, that was going to be a nice matchup during the course of the night.
Well, Mark, that time Colorado's in zone coverage, really playing too deep. You're going to see Wheatley right here, the corner, and the safety trying to get over the top, but another void in the zone coverage. I mean, the corner gets caught inside instead of funneling them back inside. There's just a big void over there on the sideline. Ryan Walters and Terrence Wheatley not in sync at all as far as technique.
As a result, it's first down and 10. Upchurch again, getting about 3 yards on the play, stopped up by Jordan Dizon. John Parker Wilson setting a couple of records tonight, passing yards and touchdowns, first respectively in school history.
Mark, the biggest one, came into this game 12-13 as a starter at Alabama.
That doesn't blow you away.
Well, what happens to even make it more is he won state championships at Hoover High School. So I mentioned before, a lot of people thought it was just an easy transition for him to come to Tuscaloosa and win national championships.
Fires another completion down to the 44-yard line to the tight end Nick Walker. Really more of a a wide receiver type who makes the catch with about 6.5 minutes to go here in the first half.
Nick Walker, an athletic tight end, lost some weight. I mean, started 24 games. You look at Nick Walker, also Travis McCall, 83. Travis McCall's really like a fullback. I mean, they move him around a lot. Walker, more of the athletic guy, catches a little bit more balls. McCall, a little bit more of the blocker.
And Bob, with that last completion to Walker, Wilson now 13 of 17 passing for 187 yards. First down and 10. And a play fake. There's a flag down in the field. It's incomplete, intended for Hull. But there's a flag down on the near side of the field at about the 46-yard line. We'll see what it's all about.
One thing you know if you're John Parker Wilson, Mark.
Illegal shift offense.
In this Alabama offense. It's kind of fun to play someone other than a Southeastern Conference defense. I mean, the speed and ability in the Southeastern Conference. I saw today the SEC number one conference of NFL players on active rosters in professional football. I mean, the ACC is number two, but there's a big gap. So no question that the Southeastern Conference defense is, John Parker's glad to get away from that.
Nick Saban very involved and integrated in his defense. First down and 15 after the penalty against the Crimson Tide. And Wilson wisely throws it away. And that's going to be a flag. He was inside the tackle still. But Cadell seemed to be in the area. They ultimately might pick this flag up.
Intentional grounding. Offense. Loss of down. The spot of the pass. Second down.
Maybe not this time.
It really did look like a receiver was in the general area.
Yeah, Cadell was in the neighborhood. Well, regardless, they're going to put it back to the 50-yard line. The loss of down, second down into 15 with 6 minutes to go here in the period. Three receiver formation. Wilson, and he's picked off. Ryan Walters with the interception for the Buffaloes. And into Alabama territory at the 43-yard line. That's Wilson's 12th interception that he's thrown so far this year.
Mark, it all started with the good pressure by George Hippolyte, number 86, who's been battling a hamstring. See, Hippolyte, a good inside move, then overpowers the guard right in the face right there, and the ball's underthrown. Ryan Walters just comes off the hash mark and gets a big turnover right there for Colorado.
It was Walters' key interception against Oklahoma that really led to their victory. It was a timely play by the defense, and Walters in particular. First down and 10 for the Buffaloes from the 43-yard line of Alabama. See if they can do anything off of this turnover. Sprague in motion. The give is to Hugh Charles, who is going nowhere. Met immediately at the 45-yard line. Number 92, Wallace Gilberry there. He was the first one. He led the SEC in tackles per loss this year and was second in the conference in sacks with 9.
Mark, at some point, Colorado is going to have to put all the pressure on Cody Hawkins. Throw the football down the field, because this lateral running game with all the reverse, fake reverse, isn't working real well against the speed of this Alabama defense.
Great point. Second and 12 coming up. Aaron Ellis now in the backfield beside Hawkins to his right. Hawkins with time and finds his receiver at the 20-yard line. It's complete to Scotty McKnight, the former walk-on, the team's leading receiver coming in.
Well, Scotty McKnight, a great story. His dad played at University of California, Davis, with Dan Hawkins. Just a little corner route right there behind the corner in front of the safety, Rashad Johnson. Nice little route against a two-deep coverage by Scotty McKnight.
A tough guy. Broke his ankle during some of the first drills in spring ball, but he came back ready to play in the fall. First down and 10 for Colorado. Charles back in the ball game. They picked up 25 on the last play.
I think the next step for this Colorado program, Mark, they need some dynamic wide receivers.
Here's
the most dynamic guy right here.
It's number 9, Josh Smith, and Smith makes it just a yard short of the first down. Smith might be, you talk about being dynamic, Bob, might be the fastest of the receivers. He and Patrick Williams, number 4.
Yeah, Mark, he is the most dynamic, a guy that can stretch the field. Just a true freshman right here. You see him on the reverse, a well-executed play. Number 77, Tyler Palumbus, the big left tackle out there blocking. But, yeah, this guy right here, no question, has a bright future. Averaged almost 20 yards a catch this year for Colorado.
Second and 2. There haven't been many second and shorts for the Buffaloes in this game. Charles the deep back, Sprague in motion. They give it to Hugh Charles, who's stopped at the line of scrimmage by, once again, Wallace Gilbert. He's made plays in big games so far this year for Alabama. A good pass rusher, but that time showing some skills against the run.
Yeah, Mark, he just closed from his defensive end position. Watch him right here. He's just going to close down the line. A lot of times what teams do, if they see an end close like this, they go ahead and bring the quarterback out of there on a naked bootleg or even a kind of a decide zone, because he really can't be closing down in there that fast now.
Here's a little rollout action. Hawkins hits his receiver, Jake Behrens, the fullback, out of the backfield, complete, and that's a first down. They picked up 4 on the play. It'll be first and goal for the Buffaloes. The first time we've said that on the night for Colorado.
Well, Mark, and this is bad news for Alabama, because you look at that stat. Alabama, goal-to-goal defense, allowed opponent to score TD on all 15 tries, the worst in the NCAA. Our stat guys now. Nick Saban's going to be upset that they dug that one up.
They're going to quick count into the end zone. Almost interception, incomplete. Broken up there by Kareem Jackson, the freshman who was all conference this year in the SEC.
Yeah, a guy from Fork Union Academy, started every game this year as a freshman. He really closed, Mark, on that football. Really a pretty good job right there of Scotty McKnight of getting the ball bounced out of there. Kind of becoming the defensive back himself.
Yeah, Jackson, one of the surprises defensively for Alabama. Hawkins now with second and goal coming up.
See a lot of shifting. Auburn did a lot of shifting against Alabama in that last game of the year.
They give it to Ellis. Runs between the tackles down to the 3-yard line. Stopped up by the strong safety, Rashad Johnson, who's the leading tackler defensively for Alabama. He, too, made all-conference this year in the SEC. Third down and goal to go, and there's no doubt. It's 4-down territory.
No question, Mark. And you see all that misdirection, all that deception by Colorado, all those moving parts. You know what makes an adjustment to that? Speed. I mean, the bottom line, all their runs seem to go east and west instead of north and south.
Ellis is the deep back out of the eye. Hawkins into the end zone. Touchdown, it's caught by DeVray. Tyson DeVray finally puts the Buffaloes on the scoreboard.
Mark, that was a great adjustment by DeVray, because Darren Mustin, 57, the linebacker, has great coverage. I mean, right here, he's covered. The ball thrown to the inside by Cody Hawkins, but great body control right there by Tyson DeVray at 6'5" to make that catch.
First time that they've thrown to him tonight. And that's his 7th touchdown catch of the season. The extra point good, and Colorado cut the lead to 20. It's 27-7. Back with more from Independence Stadium right after this.
See every BCS game live and exclusive on NASN. The Rose Bowl. The Sugar Bowl. The Fiesta Bowl. The Orange Bowl. And the BCS National Championship game live from New Orleans. The Bowl Championship Series live this January on NASN.
For Reebok official NFL jerseys and much more, visit NASN.com.
There are 380,000 NCAA student athletes. And most of us will go
and
pro.
Most of us will go pro in something other than
other
sports.
In something other than sports. Go to NCAAstudent.org to find out how.
College basketball continues on NASN with a live triple header. We tip off the night in Boston to see high-flying Kansas take on the Eagles. Next up, it's Manny Harris and the Wolverines at Purdue. Then it's the battle for the Bluegrass as Louisville take on the Kentucky Wildcats. A live college basketball triple header this Saturday, only on NASN.
Tyson DeBrey with the touchdown catch a few moments ago. The transfer from Western Michigan, former All-MAC performer, set out the 05 season, finally puts Colorado on the scoreboard, capping that 8-play, 43-yard drive. Used up 3:43 on the clock. It's 27-7.
All started, Mark, with the turnover. John Parker Wilson throwing that football into coverage.
At the 12-yard line, this is DJ Hall. Hall goes down just shy of the 20-yard line. Let's go back to Reese Davis in the studio. Reese, season's greetings to you.
All right, Mark, coming up on the Flomax Halftime Report, we'll check in on the Titans and the Colts. Titans win, they make the playoffs. They're up 7-3 at the moment. Skins took care of their business. They're in the NFC playoffs. We'll also get you set for a New Year's Eve day and night full of bowl games. Lou Holtz, Mark May join me. We'll see you in just a little while.
All right, you got it, Reese.
Reese, a huge Alabama fan.
Yes, got those Alabama roots.
Probably contributing to that Nick Saban fund at Alabama, paying the coach.
Yeah, Reese got it right there. Yeah, when Reese writes a check, the bank bounces. That's Glenn Coffey. Gets back to the line of scrimmage, but this first half has been dominated by the Crimson Tide. Alonzo Barrett made the stop on the play as Colorado calls a timeout.
Mark, that was a great play by Alonzo Barrett, the right defensive end. Right there, whips number 71, Andre Smith, who was the SEC most outstanding blocker, big number 71. That was a heck of a play right there.
Yeah, no small feat when you talk about some of the accolades that Smith has garnered this year. First team All-SEC.
Barrett played his high school football in the state of Alabama. His sister was actually married yesterday. I guess the whole wedding party's at the game.
That's a heck of a weekend.
Yeah, that's his mom right there.
Made it back from the wedding. Andy Barrett. You know, Alonzo with a nice play a few moments ago.
You know, we talked about Andre Smith, the offensive lineman from Alabama. He's one of the best offensive linemen I've seen, Mark, big number 71. This guy was Mr. Football in Alabama. The first time ever an offensive lineman won that award. First team All-SEC. Started 13 games last year as a freshman. Actually caught a touchdown pass last year.
Looked kind of nimble on his feet.
In the Independence Bowl, right?
Yeah, a little tackle eligible player.
So you know, well, he may not bring it up to Nick Saban, but he'd like to get another opportunity.
Be one of those, hey, coach, you think you might want to pull this one out for him? Meanwhile, the delay on the field is due to a stadium clock issue, which they have now since resolved with 1:56 to go here in the first half. Second down and 10 coming up for Alabama. And down in motion. Wilson goes through his progression and almost found another Buffalo. Incomplete, and man, that's one that maybe they should have had.
Well, Mark, you see what gets John Parker Wilson into trouble and has got this Alabama football team in trouble. Inaccuracy by the quarterback has taken away all the momentum Alabama had in the game. I mean, that was a poorly thrown football. Jimmy Smith, the corner, he picked one off against Nebraska early in the second half and took it back. So all of a sudden now, that fragile confidence, even though it's a 27-7 game, starting to bite John Parker Wilson a little bit again.
Well, Bob, his last three passes, no completions, and that one interception that led to the touchdown. This time, plays it safe, hands it off to Coffey. Coffey with a first down. Gives them a little more breathing room out to the 35-yard line. With 1:42 to go, he picked up 16 on the play.
Mark, really, if you're Colorado right there, don't you have to play run or screen because the quarterback is struggling so much? The Colorado played pass, was in a three-man front. That was like stealing right there. It was a huge gap.
Wilson hit as he released the ball by number 40, Brad Jones. And it's incomplete as a result. Getting a little bit of pressure on the quarterback that time was Brad Jones, the second-year starter.
Yeah, Mark, that was a great speed move right there by Brad Jones. Watch him. He's the left defensive end. He's going to run right around big number 78 right there, Mike Johnson. Mike Johnson moved from guard to tackle. That's not an easy transition, and that time he just got beat on the speed rush.
They had some issues on the offensive line this year. That time, Coffey running it. Got maybe a yard on the play. At fourth down coming up. I talked about the offensive line being affected by various issues. One of them, there were suspensions earlier this year doled out to five different players, some of them on the offensive line, for violating the textbook disbursement policy that they have at Alabama. Yeah, and that kind of coincided with the four-game slide that they subsequently went into, Bob.
It really did. I mean, the lack of continuity on that offensive line. It was unfortunate. I think it was five players for four games. But isn't it amazing how when you turn the football over, it takes away your confidence and your energy as a football team? All of a sudden, Alabama, a little bit back on their heels since that interception two series ago by John Parker Wilson. But that is a big, good-looking offensive line. If they can get them all intact. And this is a young, young Alabama football team.
This is the first time that the offensive line has been whole in a long time. Third and nine coming up.
Interesting to see if they'll let John Parker Wilson, Mark, throw this football down the field right here.
Not on this play. They handed off to Coffey, who got drilled back at the 32-yard line. Brandon Nicholas came in, the former transfer from Notre Dame, to make the play for Colorado with 1:21 to go in the first half. Fourth down coming up for Alabama.
Mark, you talk about a great play. Watch Nicholas right here lined up right over the center. And, I mean, he is just going to whip this one-on-one block right here. Watch. This is a great play. He slants that way, and the center had no help. But that time you see again a little bit of lack of confidence not wanting John Parker Wilson to throw that ball down the field.
Colorado, meanwhile, calls a timeout, and we're going to answer our Aflac trivia question in the meantime and in between time. Stacy, by the way, didn't get a duck
well,
for Christmas
either.
Well,
I bet Reese and Mark and Lou
they might have gotten
got
ours.
Their ducks.
Okay. Who's the only Alabama coach since 1987 to win a bowl game in his first season? Shula, Franchione, DeBose, or Gene Stallings? The correct answer, Dennis Franchione, the 2001 win over Iowa State in the Independence Bowl.
How about all the coaches moving around? Huh? Interim coaches coaching in the bowl game. Wow.
I would think there should be some kind of legislation against changes at that time of the year. I don't know if it's possible.
Yeah, there ought to be a way to at least finish the season with the team you started the season with, right?
It brought a little bit of heat that time.
Oh.
And it's mishandled, loose, out of bounds.
Mark,
Chase McBride couldn't get a handle on it.
It hit him on the helmet. Yeah. It's a good thing it is helmet because it forced the football out of bounds. Watch this right here. Boom. That's the good news. If it would hit his shoulder pad, it would have stayed in bounds. But there's enough velocity on that ball now. Mark, he took his eyes off.
What was he doing?
Oh, man.
It's tough not to laugh at that. I'm sorry. I mean,
why
misfortune
did, you know,
of Chase
he looked
McBride.
Away for it a second right there.
I'm trying to figure out what exactly he had in mind.
I'll tell you what, he took a pop on that helmet now with that football.
Oh, moves the ball out to the 45-yard line. Byron Ellis, the lone back, beside the quarterback Cody Hawkins on first down and 10. No timeouts remaining for the Buffaloes. The pass is complete short of the first down at the 46 to Tyson DeVray, who has the only touchdown of the game for the Buffaloes so far.
You know, Mark, Colorado has struggled with their shotgun snaps. Daniel Sanders, number 75. Looks like they're putting Cody under the center right here, which is a good move.
little subtle change, and the pass complete once again. And once again to DeVray, it looks like he picked up enough for the first down and got out of bounds to stop the clock. 1 yard catch by DeVray.
Talk about Daniel Sanders. He's had a great year. And they told us, Mark Helfrich, the offensive coordinator, not a lot of credit. Mark, he's struggling with these shotgun snaps a little bit now.
That time he got it to the quarterback, Hawkins. Fires complete. Oh, man, DeVray hung on to it in heavy, deep traffic.
Mark, two things impressive. Cody Hawkins standing in there against the blitz and setting his feet. And Tyson DeVray, athletic, 6'5".
They moved it down the field in a hurry. This time they're going to spike it to stop the clock and maybe call a couple of plays. Colorado gets a touchdown here. It kind of changes the complexion of the game in a big way.
It does, and not to beat a dead horse, but the turnovers by Alabama, you think the Mississippi State game, right before the half, John Parker Wilson threw the interception. I believe Mississippi State ran that back for a touchdown.
Yeah, over 100 yards.
Exactly. So the timing of those interceptions taking away the momentum of Alabama.
Looking at 2nd and 10 now for Colorado. They go back to the shotgun formation. The pass is complete, but for a gain of just about 2 yards to Patrick Williams. Colorado with no timeouts remaining in the half. That's Williams' first catch of the game. First time they've actually thrown in his direction. Clock running with 14 seconds to go.
Right, very easily could be the last play of the half right here for Colorado.
They go into the end zone on it. Close to it. It's a catch. Touchdown. Wow. Dusty Sprague with a touchdown catch. Working against Kareem Jackson. What an ending to the half for Colorado.
And Mark Helfrich, their offensive coordinator, said this about Dusty Sprague. He said he's just slow enough. Kind of kidding about his speed, but that time the ball underthrown. Dusty Sprague comes back to the football and makes the catch. And Colorado back from the dead. Kareem Jackson, the corner, beat on the underthrown ball.
Sprague, meanwhile, with his third touchdown catch of the season. And that really puts Colorado folks back in the ballgame, down by just 13 points. And Nick Saban's team has seen itself lose a lot of the momentum they had going. And it all started with that Wilson interception a few drives ago.
And, Mark, they dodged the helmet to football contact on the punt.
That was
to
a key
take
play.
The football down. Key play.
Gave them a few more yards instead of him trying to run that thing. And wonder what Wilson is thinking right now. Dusty Sprague, meanwhile, teased incessantly about his speed or lack thereof by his teammates. But, Bob, you see it so many times. You hear it so many times. The underthrown deep ball, a tough one to defend against.
Mark, it is no question the hardest to defend. And isn't it amazing how quickly body language, facial expressions change? I mean, you think Colorado was ahead right now looking at that sidelines and the dejection over on the Alabama side and the fragile state of the quarterback, John Parker Wilson.
And keep in mind that the Buffaloes will get the ball to start the third quarter, too.
And, you know, Colorado dodged a little bullet with time clock management right there. You know, just barely getting that play off with enough time left in the first half.
The turn comes all the way out to the 42-yard line. The Buffaloes with 14 points in the last 5:44 of the half. And they go into the locker room trailing now with a little bit more of the quote-unquote Hawk love that they mystically talk about on campus in Boulder. Sprague with a touchdown catch. DeVray had one as we go down to Stacy.
Coach Saban, a shift in the momentum there towards the end of the half. What becomes your halftime address with your players?
Well, I think what we got to do is play for 60 minutes in the game. We knew this was going to be a tough game. We got off to a good start. We didn't always capitalize on our opportunities, and we got to do a little bit better job on defense, you know, especially playing pass defense. That's how they got back in the game. So, you know, we went 2 minutes. We were being aggressive there, and they ended up getting the ball back and scoring.
All right, thanks, Coach.
All right, Stacy. Alabama still with the lead, though. Wilson hot early, cold late, as we go to Reese Davis, Mark May, and Lou Holtz for the Flomax Halftime Report. Guys?
Welcome back to ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Welcome, everyone, to Independence Stadium. It's the 32nd edition of the Petro Sun Independence Bowl at the half. Alabama leading 27-14. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey. Stacey Dale's joining us in just a few moments. Season's greetings from us at ESPN to all of you at home. Bob, the score, 27-14, a little bit deceiving when you consider what happened in the last 5.5 minutes of that second quarter. Colorado snatching back the momentum. Where do they go from here now in the third quarter?
Well, Mark, you're right. I mean, when you're down 27-0, it's hard to come back unless the team that's ahead helps you a little bit. And Alabama helped Colorado a little bit there at the end of the first half. But the good news for Colorado, they can play much better. Threw an interception the first play of the game, went for it on fourth down, didn't make it, had a punt blocked, and turned some guys loose coverage-wise in the secondary. So Dan Hawkins and Colorado can play much, much better than they played. Interesting to see if John Parker Wilson, the Alabama quarterback, can rebound from a sluggish end to the first half.
We heard from Nick Saban going into the locker room from Alabama. Stacey Dale spoke with Coach Hawkins a few moments ago. Stacey, what do you say?
Well, you said pretty much what Bob Davey said. We had some missed opportunities in the first half, and we had to settle down. He said we're a very young team, and this bowl game was a big deal for us coming into it. But once we knocked the fog off and gained some confidence, we were just fine. It's real simple, guys. Offensively, he wants to get the ball to Hugh Charles, and he wants to run.
Well, Hugh Charles had some moments in the first half, and they'll get a chance here with the ball in the third quarter. And Charles with his hands on the ball in this kickoff return. North-south at the end of that run out to the 25-yard line, brought down by Rashad Johnson. Well, Cody Hawkins' night started off impropitiously, unfavorably. The first pass, the first offensive play, he was picked off by Rolando McClain.
One thing about Cody Hawkins, though, he is a resilient guy. I mean, this kid was 59-0 from the 6th grade to the 12th grade in Idaho. He is a confident, almost cocky, borders on cocky guy, and he is very resilient.
We had a chance to meet him a couple of seasons ago on our ESPNU Summer House feature. If you can spend a few weeks with Chris Spielman getting roughed up there.
Yeah. You know, I did one of those episodes. I went up to Chicago and took part in that.
Here's Hugh Charles with the first run, the first play of the second half, and somebody's hat came loose. Charles goes down after a gain of about one on the play.
I think it's important. I think it's important, Mark, for Colorado to run the football north and south and let you, Charles, go downhill a little bit. You obviously see that big cast on Rolando McClain's wrist right there.
Bob, he didn't have that in the first half.
Yeah, and you notice Prince Hall was in there and played a lot of football. But, Mark, I think Colorado needs to run right out of Alabama. All the misdirection sideways stuff almost has no chance with the speed of the Alabama defense.
We're going to say no gain on first down. They give it to Charles for another opportunity. This time Charles will get positive yardage. Got about four. Out to the 28-yard line, call it. Lorenzo Washington making the stop on the play.
Yeah, it looks like a face mask potential right there on number 97, Lorenzo Washington. That probably should have been called, Mark.
Yeah. Got a handful of face mask on that one. No penalty, so it's third down and 7.
Boy, big third down just to see if Colorado can keep the momentum they had at the end of the first half.
Set up out of the shotgun. You got a whistle down to the field and a penalty. Actually, no, the penalty. You're going to call a timeout. Colorado got the timeout before the play clock expired.
Alabama moved a little bit late right there into a blitz look. Colorado went ahead and used the timeout.
See if they can convert on the other side. We'll be right back after this. This telecast is available in phenomenal high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Foodway. Third down coming up for the Buffaloes. Hawkins under some heat. Got it off, and it's complete at the 39-yard line. Scotty McKnight picks up the first down and 11 yards on the play.
Mark, give credit to Cody Hawkins that time. just staying calm under pressure, then moving the pocket a little bit, sliding out of there, and then slinging this football on the run. I mean, he throws very well on the run. That is a very accurate throw. Huge first down here to start the second half for Colorado.
First down and 10 at the 39. Byron Ellis the lone back. Three receiver formation for the Buffaloes. Smith in motion. He gets the handoff. And Josh Smith with a pretty good game. Got about five on the play. His forward progress going to be marked right around the 45-yard line. He was stomped up by Rashad Johnson.
Mark, we haven't talked much about Dan Hawkins. You talk about a guy that went 12-1, 13-1, 11-1 in 3 years at Boise. A little bit of a Zen master. I mean, you mentioned he calls it Hawk love, combination of friendship and coaching to develop the players. I'll tell you what, this guy is a good football coach. I mean, you get a little bit of a misconception about him that maybe he's easygoing with the whole Zen master. He's a tough disciplinarian. I think he's doing a great job at Colorado.
Interesting when it comes to dealing with his son, the starting quarterback. This is Hugh Charles dancing outside. Flag down. Charles got a nice block. And it might come back because of a hold. Charles got loose. Dusty Sprague was out there. And he's probably the one that's going to be whistled for the hold. Mark, 7 yard right. Pickup if it stands, but let's get back to
holding offense. 92 10-yard penalty from the previous spot.
Yeah, I think that was on 83 down. Dusty Sprague right there.
But getting back to Hawkins, when he first took the job, he said, you know, we can pop this thing. Speaking of the program, we don't know when it'll happen, but when it does, it'll roar. As far as dealing with his son, the starting quarterback, he says that the best part about coaching him is showing him how to be a man and a good football player. The worst part of it is putting up a small barrier when at times he'd usually have to wink at Cody after a good play when normally he'd be slobbering all over him, as a lot of doting fathers would.
You talk about a lightning rod. Your son is the starting quarterback at a place like Colorado as a freshman. I mean, the head coach and the quarterback in major college football are lightning rods. They're both in that same family.
Hawkins completes it to Smith. And Smith with a first down at the 43-yard line into Alabama territory.
I'll tell you what now. We talked earlier about Josh Smith, 6 foot, 180 freshman, being the most dynamic wide receiver. And this is the next step for the Colorado program, getting more dynamic speed. That time, just a post route.
And a 22-yard pickup. Boy, what about the start of the season that he had? He ran into a wall during one of the summer practice sessions they had and incurred a kidney problem after that, was able to bounce back, missed the first two games of the season, but now an important part of what they like to do offensively. Sumler in the tailback, little play fake. Hawkins, it's going to be complete. DeVray, who had a touchdown catch in the first half, makes the catch there to pick up 13. And this, Bob, this offense for the Buffalo is starting to get a little bit of rhythm to it.
And I'll tell you what, now the quarterback is heating up. And how about Tyson DeVray again, the second leading receiver, and he's a tight end. How about that throw and catch, Mark? Wow, that is impressive right there. Look at him lay out, and that's a catch. I mean, he had the football in control and the hand underneath it. That's a big time. He's made some athletic plays tonight, Tyson DeVray.
Six catches for a total of 52 yards. Hugh Charles back in. Play fake to him. Hawkins up top. Has a man and overshot Williams, his receiver. Josh Smith was in behind his guy, too. And Smith didn't have enough speed to catch up to that. That was an overthrow.
Really good pass protection. Watch Tyler Palumbus right here, Mark. I mean, this guy has started every snap the last 2 years in the program. I mean, that is stoning the guy. But 893 snaps this year, every snap, and 715 last year. That is a lot of snaps now.
Ryan Lockridge in the tailback on second and 10, a near miss. Boy, that's a lot of moving parts, a lot of variables, none of them going anywhere as Rolando McClain made the stop. That freshman has been on a lot of plays. Lockridge got stopped up, but McClain, the all-freshman SEC selection, is coming off a big game against Auburn at 15 tackles and interception against the Tigers in that loss.
Mark, you can do all the misdirection you want, but you better block someone. Watch Broderick Diedrich right here, the defensive lineman. I mean, they just turn him loose. I mean, you better have some misdirection in the backfield if you're just going to turn that big cat loose now.
Ellis in the backfield, third and long. They've converted on the previous one. Tipped up and almost intercepted by McLean.
Well, he only has one hand.
Yeah. That thing was wrapped a little bit in the first half, Bob, but not quite as heavily as it is right now. The thumb was wrapped in the first half.
Well, if you watch it, Mark, he never lifted his left hand up at all to try to intercept that football. I mean, the ball ricocheted out of there pretty quick, but I mean, that's probably about 10 pounds worth of cast right there.
He's looking at maybe about a 48-yard field goal by Kevin Eberhardt. And he pulls this one to the left. Eberhardt now 15 of 24 on the season after that miss. So a promising looking drive to start the second half for Colorado ends up missing by about that much.
I'm an accountant and I'm visually impaired. So to help me, my office supplies all my paperwork in large print.
I'm a builder and I have diabetes. My boss lets me have a few short breaks during the day so I can manage my blood glucose levels.
I'm a shop assistant and I'm a wheelchair user. My boss lowered my cash desk so I could work comfortably.
I work in IT. My office is on the third floor. I have arthritis, so these stairs can sometimes be a bit tough. All my boss needs to do is to put my desk on the ground floor.
As employers, we can all make reasonable adjustments to help our employees and customers who are disabled. They needn't be expensive or time-consuming to implement.
Sometimes it's the smallest changes that make the biggest difference. For a practical guide, visit dwp.gov.uk/DDA.
Sometimes you just got to have the right bait to get the catch, and so far Alabama's had it. At least they did in the first half. We'll see what they have here in the second half. Glenn Coffey, the lone back, pass to Nick Walker. And Walker has the first down. He's still on his feet. He's got about six guys mauling him there. Pick up 12.
I think Nick didn't want to go down right there. Talk about for Alabama, Mark, amazing statistic. You know, they've lost eight straight games in the month of November. They lost four of their last five games last year. So in 2 years, eight straight losses to finish the season in November. Now, the good news, it's December, right?
Yeah, there's got to be
some good news here. But just kind of some late season collapses there, back-to-back years.
A different coach, but the same result, unfortunately, for Alabama. Late in the season, this is Coffey stacked up after a gain of about one by Jordan Dizon. Dizon, a four-year starter, great story for Colorado, and John Parker Wilson. See how he reacts here in the second half. Got off to a hot start, but threw an interception in the second quarter, which really swung the momentum in Colorado's favor. Since that hot start, just 4 of 8. Second down and 8 coming up. Wilson had a lot of air under that. Almost got intercepted at the 32. Closest player to the football was wearing a black and gold jersey. Number 9. That's Daniel Dykes of the Buffaloes.
Well, Mark, great effort again by Brandon Nicholas, the nose guard. Watch him right over the center. That's his helmet right there. 94. Watch the effort. I mean, he's blocked. He just keeps coming, and again, now there, John Parker Wilson didn't have a great opportunity to set those feet, but one thing that gets him in trouble is he shuffles those feet a little bit, and that leads to some inaccuracy in his throws.
In a blink, it's 3rd and 8 for Alabama here. Wilson, incomplete, intended for Cadell, and it's time to punt for the Crimson Tide. Colorado going to get this football back. And Chase McBride goes back to the 15-yard line for Colorado. Chase McBride providing us with a little bit of levity, unfortunately, for him in the first half on that punt. Had the ball bounce off his dome. Well, ended up gaining some yardage out of it, too. Went out of bounds.
Colorado's improved remarkably, marking four or five special teams areas this year. Much improved.
Oh, man. Fitzgerald got hit. The ball bounces by McBride and Marquez Herrick. Wow. Looked like he ran into the punter, Fitzgerald.
Yeah, I think it's going to be running into 5-yard penalty right here. At least I hope that's the call. Yeah. 5-yard penalty. They're going to decline that, I would think.
Running into the kicker. 5-yard penalty. Repeat fourth down.
They're going to run it over again. They're going to punt it again.
Yeah, Mark, let's see. Yeah, that's running into the kicker.
But I'm not so sure that he touched him.
Into the kicker.
I'm not sure that he touched him.
Yeah. Would you talk about all the movies they're doing in Shreveport now? Because New Orleans has obviously some problems. So
yeah,
moved
this
it up here.
This is now third in the country, this area, especially Shreveport, in movie production making, behind just New York and California. So, yeah, a couple of actors looking for some gigs, Bob.
That was an Emmy potential right there.
Back with more right after this. Colorado Buffaloes 97 yards away from the Alabama end zone on first down and 10 here after that punt. The official with a misinterpretation was not first down, fourth down. They took the ball, Colorado did, and Hugh Charles gets about 3 yards on the play. Look at our game recap right now. Boy, Wilson came out with a hot hand for Alabama to start the game. They jumped into a huge early lead. Wilson with 3 touchdown passes in the game so far. Stover on that one. Was not flagged for a penalty. And DeVray helping to serve as the catalyst for the comeback for Colorado. And then Dusty Sprague with a touchdown reception there. Second down and 7 right now for the Buffaloes. This is Ellis. And Ellis got about 3 or 4 on the play. It'll be third down coming up for Colorado.
Mark, they have really struggled with that sideways sweep action running game. I know it's going to be a big part of their plan next year. They've got a great opportunity to look at it tonight, but that has not gone real well for Dan Hopkins. You know, interesting, his favorite food I saw on a survey, and I know this is the only one of the 119.
You're deep in those notes, man.
Would say this, Mongolian food. Wow. Now, not many ball coaches out of the 119. I'm going out on a limb saying he's the only one of this Mongolian food is his favorite.
I think there's a coach out in Hawaii in the Pacific Rim area that might like Mongolian food. But yeah, I'll agree with you on that. And Hawkins, the coach's son at quarterback, with the completion to Joe Sanders at tight end. And they convert for the first down. They pick up 13. Sanders with his first catch of the game. Now DeVray and Sanders both with receptions out of that position.
Mark, Alabama playing man-to-man coverage. And Ezekiel Knight bumped into his own guy right there and turned a tight end open in the flat.
And what about Hawkins, Bob? Completions on 9 of his last 12 passes. It's been a different quarterback since like that middle part of the second period.
No question, Mark. And he, as I mentioned, he is a resilient guy now.
Handed off and nothing happening. That's the second consecutive time that that play was blown up, this time by Wallace Gilbert. Led the SEC in tackles for loss, was second this year in the SEC in sacks with 9.
Mark, again, if you watch Gilberry, I mean, they're just unblocked.
Why is that happening, Constance?
It's just a slow-developing kind of play in the penetration of the Alabama front, just an athletic front. Gilberry, you mentioned, leads the SEC in tackles for losses. This is an attacking, penetrating front. And those slow-developing offensive plays, they just can't block them up front. The angles aren't right.
Second and 15 as a result. Dumps it off incomplete for Ellis, out of bounds. Dangerously close to being a lateral and staying alive ball. Instead, it counts as an incompletion, sets up a third and 15 now.
Mark, we mentioned Colorado starts two true freshman offensive linemen. Watch the right tackle, Ryan Miller. Here we look at Columbus. Pretty good job right there. But you see at the top right there, 73, Ryan Miller. One of the toughest things is pass protection for a young guy. But this guy, he'll be a great player because he's coachable. But he'll miss a guy every once in a while.
You think they got to protect him here on third and 15, passing situation. Hawkins completes it for the first down. Right at the 35-yard line, Josh Smith picks up 18. And, boy, Hawkins took a hit, it seemed, after he made the completion.
Mark, great protection, though, early, particularly by the center. Watch the center right here in pass protection handle this twist stunt. Watch the twist come around, and he just rides number 47, Ezekiel Knight, out of there. And then again, Josh Smith on the square in route, but really good protection right there on third down and 15.
And the coaches say that Smith has the potential to be their best wide receiver. First down and 10. Hawkins with some backside pressure closing. Dangerously close to being picked off. Boy, Rolando McClain is ubiquitous. He is all over the field tonight. On this play, comes off the field writhing in pain, though.
That's his other hand. You know, one of the toughest things for a young linebacker is pass coverage. A lot of these guys out of high school can play the run. Rolando McClain, playing with one arm, Mark, does a great job in pass protection. He kind of came down on that right hand.
Yeah.
Looks like a shoulder, doesn't it?
Yeah. They're reaching up under that right shoulder pad to work on him. Second down and 10, meanwhile, for Colorado.
That helps if he was a tight end in high school. Maybe that's why he's so good.
Oh, boy. Hugh Charles on the loose for the Buffaloes. And into Alabama territory is Hugh Charles. You hear the what sound like boos. They're not saying boo. They're saying Hugh, the Buffalo fans that have made the trip here to Shreveport. He got 27.
You're right. And Ryan Miller, number 73, gets an excellent block. Watch him right here. Stay with the block. And that springs Hugh Charles. Might have a little hand on the jersey, but Mark, that's good athleticism now for a 6'7", 330-pound freshman, Ryan Miller, number 73.
Finding their way on offense right now with 5:14 to go in the third period.
Again, you see all the shifts pre-snap by Colorado.
Little play fake. They set up the screen, and nothing happened. Well read by Alabama. There were more Alabama players in the area than Colorado players. Ezekiel Knight there to break it all up.
Yeah, every once in a while, that freshman creeps back in to Cody Hawkins. And I mean, that time, Mark, he really ill-advised. Just kind of threw that one up for grabs.
Well, he has shown a lot of resilience on the season. His dad was telling us about the Texas Tech game when he took a knock, came out of the game to the sidelines, was being examined by some of the team doctors, actually thought he was playing against West Virginia.
It's amazing because West Virginia's on the schedule next year. Maybe that's a good omen. Right? I mean,
thinking ahead?
Yeah, they weren't on the schedule this year, but next year they're on it. That's a coach's son, right? Always thinking about the future.
He got scrambled a little bit. On the run, this is Robinson, and Stephon Robinson with a nice gain. Down to the 23-yard line, picked up 15 and got another Buffalo first down.
Now, Mark, when you're going to play man-to-man coverage, you're going to get the jailbreak screen, the ball thrown behind the line of scrimmage. You see the lineman, the freshman 51, Key Mahava, downfield, which as long as the ball's thrown behind the line, you're allowed downfield. There's his sister now. Made a huge impact on you today because she's a track athlete.
Yeah, a very promising hurdler at the University of Texas. Speed running in the family. 11th play of the drive for Colorado here. The handoff is to Ellis, and he's dragged down from behind by Wallace Gilberry, his fourth tackle for loss in this ball game.
Again, Gilberry, they come with the blitz off the corner, Alabama. So Gilberry really doesn't have contain that time. So, Mark, he just closes right down the line of scrimmage. It takes too long to get these plays developed on all these sweeps.
Yeah, talked about Gilberry's friendship with Chuck Smith, the former NFL All-Pro. Smith talked to him frequently about the late Reggie White and the late Derek Thomas and their respective work ethic and their techniques, and it's made a huge impact on Gilbert's progression during the course of the season. Hawkins swings it and wisely throws it out of bound. Patrick Williams, the closest receiver in the area, flagged down on the play.
Well, it looks like holding, doesn't it?
Trying to figure out why. Yeah, Gilbert is clapping.
Boy, Mark, that's two huge negative plays in a row for Colorado.
Penalty from the previous spot.
Number 51, the freshman, Kai Ma'ava from Hawaii.
Let's go back to Reese for the SportsCenter 30 at 30 update. Reese?
All right, Mark, the Redskins are on their way to the playoffs. They beat the Cowboys 27-6. Clinton Portis went for over 100 yards, scored a couple of touchdowns. They get a date with the Seahawks next Saturday at 4:30 Eastern time. There's one spot up for grabs in the AFC. If the Titans can beat the Colts, they're in. Fourth quarter now, tied at 10. Vince Young was injured, left the game. Kerry Collins in at quarterback.
All right, Vince Young has struggled with some injuries, especially earlier this year. That pass incomplete, intended for Jake Behrens.
Mark, you know, let me make the point. Everybody, a lot of people want a playoff in college football, right?
Uh-huh.
But do you see when you have playoffs like today in the NFL, all these teams with the dilemma, do we try to win? Should we rest our players if we're in the playoffs already? Kind of a throwaway game. Is that really what we want in college football?
It compromises the
game. There's no question. Yeah. And particularly, we only play 12 games in college football. In the NFL, they play 16. Maybe they can throw away a game.
Right.
But the great thing about college football, every game matters. I don't want to go see the starters rest if I'm a college football fan late in the season because I'm in the playoffs.
Third down coming up. Third and long. 23 to go. The catch made. Now to the 22-yard line, that's number 21, Scotty McKnight for the Buffalo, short of the first down. And in comes the field goal unit for Coach Hawkins.
Mark, there's no question that Colorado can throw the football on Alabama. And again, Eberhardt with another opportunity. This guy had five field goals down in Waco against Baylor, one of them a 52-yarder, so he has plenty of distance.
He's hit some big ones this year, game winners against Colorado State as well as against Oklahoma. This one from 39, missed earlier, and doinks this one off the left upright, and it's good from 39.
I thought it was the exact same kick from the exact same spot he missed earlier in the third quarter. What'd you call that? He doinked it?
He got that.
I didn't see that in the coaching man. No.
Got that Hawk Love mojo working for him on that kick. Back with more after this.
From the people who brought you College Game Day and the worldwide leader in sports comes the biggest thing to hit college football in years, College Football Live, a new way to get your fix every weekday with breaking news, exclusive interviews, and packed full of previews and predictions. Get ahead of the game every weekday with College Football Live on NASN.
Druids Glen Golf Resort, voted European Golf Resort of the Year 2005, a golfer's paradise in the Garden of Ireland. Two championship golf courses of contrasting design. The luxurious Marriott Druids Glen Hotel and Country Club, featuring 148 specially appointed guest rooms and a magnificent spa and health center. Visit our driving range, pro shops, golf academy, and get your golfing tips or tuition from our resident PGA teaching professional.
College basketball continues on NASN with a live triple header. We tip off the night in Boston to see high-flying Kansas take on the Eagles. Next up, it's Manny Harris and the Wolverines at Purdue. Then it's the battle for the Bluegrass as Louisville take on the Kentucky Wildcats. A live college basketball tripleheader this Saturday, only on NASN.
Welcome, everyone, back to the Petro Sun Independence Bowl here at Independence Stadium in Shreveport, Louisiana, the 32nd edition. As it stands right now, 27-17, Colorado with a 17-0 run since the middle of the second quarter of play. See DJ Hall there ready to get this kickoff for Alabama. It's been a relatively quiet night for him. This is Arenas. Javier Arenas, oh, he put it on spin cycle. Nice move. And he makes it out to the 40-yard line. Let's check in with Stacy downstairs.
Well, Mark, just a quick update for you guys on linebacker Rolando McClain for Alabama. He's had a really good night, but it hasn't come without a little bit of pain. Remember in the first half, he took a fall, injured that right thumb on the tackle here, as you see. They took him back. They casted him up at the half. And then here in the third quarter, he took a back tumble and injures his right shoulder. Now, he's been looked at by the medical staff here on the sidelines. They've done some functional movements. They've inserted a blue pad just in under his right shoulder pad, guys, and it looks like he'll come back out.
Yeah, he's been an integral part, Stacy, of what they've done tonight defensively. Glenn Coffey with the run, got about three, and there's a look at the young freshman on the sidelines for Alabama. Rolando McClain, all SEC, all freshman this year.
And a look at Jordan Dizon, the team MVP at Colorado. Let me see if I can circle him right here. Watch this inside-out pursuit right here.
What does it say about Colorado's defense, Bob, that we haven't said his name as much as we thought we might tonight?
Yeah, Mark, I mean, the guy is a tackling machine now from the state of Hawaii. Started as a true freshman, number 44, Jordan Dizon.
Wilson completes it over the middle, and it's fumbled, comes loose. Still live, it's Colorado football. Brown, Chappelle Brown recovers the loose ball. He had it ripped loose, but it's out of bounds. It'll be Buffalo football with under 2 minutes to go. Cadell made the reception for Alabama, and it was ripped loose. So the Buffaloes now looking pretty good.
And Mark, that's a huge turnover, but Mike Johnson from Alabama, 78. Watch as this thing develops. I mean, this play's been open all night, right in the middle of that zone. The ball pops out. Let's take a look at it, make sure it comes out. Yeah, it's out. The ball's out. The knee is not down. And it looks like Jeff Smart knocked that football out. And Chappelle Brown came up with the recovery.
Well, this has looked like two entirely different games on the reverse. And Josh Smith, maybe the fastest player on that team, couldn't get to the edge. Mustin ran him down, the former transfer from Middle Tennessee State University. Makes the play defensively for Alabama.
Now, Mark, let's go back and look right there. That is a tremendous play by Mike Johnson, the offensive guard. I mean, that potentially saved a touchdown right there. Very seldom you see an offensive lineman chase the football and lay out. He's still sucking air, but that was a great effort by Mike Johnson.
You will give some offensive linemen some love.
Come on, that's a great effort. I mean, not many guys know that. I noticed that right there.
Second down and 15. Hawkins completes it to DeVray. Got about a yard. It'll be third and long coming up for Colorado. See if they can convert on the turnover. Right around midfield right now with under a minute to play in the third quarter. Colorado with two timeouts remaining. Alabama with three.
You know, Mark, it's always little things that don't show up in those stats. I mean, not to belabor the Mike Johnson tackle, but all of a sudden, look now, it's third and 15. Alabama, a great opportunity to get the football back. And what could have been a touchdown if he didn't make that open field tackle.
Hawkins got a little backside pressure, stepped up, makes the play, and a first down for the Buffaloes in Alabama's 30-yard line. The catch made by Brian Lockridge. A 22-yard pickup.
Mark. Kai Mayava, the freshman offensive guard. Watch him right here. Just late come out and block the corner fire. Keep in mind, this is a freshman. Watch him right there. Just change the angle of number three, Kareem Jackson, and allowed Cody to step up and make that throw.
It's tough to miss our guy Mayava with that long flowing mane out the back of his helmet. As we approach the end of the third quarter, Colorado's hopes have been disembalmed, disentombed. They are alive, folks, and well. 15 minutes to play in the Petro Sun Independence Bowl. Great finish coming up. Back in Shreveport, Louisiana, in northwest Louisiana, and for some folks, they had to dig deep into their pockets to make it here to Shreveport. And it's first down and 10 from the 30-yard line. First play of the fourth quarter. Out of the shotgun, Hawkins fakes it. And he's going to be sacked back at the 38. Cody Hawkins maybe made the wise play that time and took the sack at the hands of Wallace Gilberry. Nobody opened downfield, so he took that one for the team.
Yeah, great effort by Gilberry. Watch him right at the top again. I mean, tough matchup. True freshman offensive tackle on a guy like Willis Gilberry with 38 starts, a three-year starter, Mark. That's a tough, tough assignment for Ryan Miller.
10th sack of the season for Gilberry. Second and 18 now for the Buffaloes. They have moved the ball in a big way here since the middle of the second quarter. That was Hugh Charles stopped up. Charles got about 2 yards on the play. Stopped up by Rolando McClain. He has put in a yeoman's effort tonight defensively for Alabama. Stacy chronicled his injuries a few moments ago, had the right thumb injury, suffered an injury to his left shoulder subsequent to that.
You know, he had an interception against Auburn as well, a parade All-American out of high school. We mentioned was a tight end in high school. So that isn't the first interception he had now, that first play of the game.
Third and 16 coming up. Hawkins threw that out of bounds. Now, what do you do on fourth and 16, Bob? Is this field goal time? Are you a little too many yards to go here for the first down? And
I think you go ahead and punt this football. I mean, it's 27-17. You've already survived a block punt. You've survived going for it on fourth down. Just take the conservative right route right now. I mean, Alabama has no offensive plays in the third quarter. They're struggling offensively. See if you can back them up right here. And this kid's done a good job of pooch punting all season for Colorado.
Delalo has 22 punts inside the 20-yard line on the season. See if he can pin Alabama. Low snap. Buffalo's downfield to cover this. This takes an Alabama bounce, though. Going to be down at about the 14-yard line. 10-point Alabama lead when we come back. Look at the Long Allen Bridge here in Shreveport, Louisiana, northwest Louisiana. Some special seasonal lights for this time of the year. 13:22 to go in the fourth quarter. Wilson fires it complete to Nick Walker, his tight end. And you hear a cheer coming from the Alabama fans. One of the few positive offensive plays that they've been able to make of late, but there's a flag down on the play.
Mark, we haven't talked about, how about Nick Saban coming back to the state of Louisiana? And playing this football game, you know, so much controversy, really, him leaving LSU and going to the Miami Dolphins. But isn't it really unfortunate how, in the case of Nick Saban, won the national championship at LSU, a lot of LSU fans upset, very similar to Rich Rodriguez leaving West Virginia. I mean, both those guys did tremendous jobs for their programs, but because they leave, a lot of animosity from the fans.
Coffee on the run gets about four, and it's interesting that we saw a bunch of LSU colors coming through the gates, ironically. Maybe some people, ironically, coming to cheer against Nick Saban in this game. But big picture coming in, Bob, we talked about it, two teams both coming in at 6-6. What does a win do here in the final game for both these teams?
It's huge. It is huge because one of these teams is going to walk out of here in 13 minutes with a winning season. One of them is going to crawl out of here with a losing season. And if you win, it's all good. If you lose, everybody's going to say you were 6-6 and didn't deserve to go to a bowl anyhow. So there is so much on the line here late in this game.
Coffee got about two or three on that play. And if win or lose, there will be some Alabama skeptics out there amongst their supporters who will say, geez, they'll start doing the math and they'll say 4 million divided by 6 or 4 million divided by 7. You do the math on that. I'm not sure what it is. But they'll say that's how much we paid Nick Saban per victory this year.
Well, I'll bet that one victory is more than what you make in a year now. Without doing the math, it's a pretty good amount now.
Well, I know that's not
I know you're way up that salary scale, but I'm going to make that bet if you get down to dividing up those wins now.
Well, it works out to $583,000 per win.
Don't give any more information.
It's coming up.
I shouldn't have put you out. Like
that's according to six victories, but, you know, I don't want to start anything with tax season around the corner. Glenn Coffey, by the way, on the carry.
But you know, it sounds sarcastic, but Alabama didn't pay $4 million to go to back-to-back Independence Bowls. But wins and losses, to me, are not the most important thing this year for Nick Saban. Yeah, it makes it easier, but building a foundation for the future, and he is doing that. This is a young football team, and he's a heck of a coach. And they're going to get back to the standards that Alabama fans expect.
3rd and 1 coming up. Coffey looks like he was stopped up short of the first down, depending on the spot. But he got a favorable spot from the officials, which may give him enough for the first down.
And Mark, Jeff Smart stepped up right there and met Coffey in the hole. Man, that yellow line is always right. And that looks like a first down right there.
The line and the spot are true, then it would appear that he has it. Coffey, meanwhile, with 18 rushes for a total of 71 yards on the night so far. And getting back to Nick Saban, it's interesting how you see the characterizations of him, Bob. There are those that say he's stoic, he's very terse, he can be very reticent to say much to the media or even beyond as they get enough for the first down. But at the end of the day, on a collegiate front, you can't argue with the success that he's had at the various coaching stops he's had, especially when you look at Michigan State and LSU and Alabama. Well, it's still in its early stages.
No, there is no question. Nick Saban is a heck of a football coach. And, you know, a lot of controversial things when you make $4 million a year and you have those press conferences every week where everybody in the state of Alabama hangs on every word you say. And that got him in a little bit of trouble after the UL Monroe loss as well.
Wilson's pass incomplete, intended for DJ Hall, and a late flag thrown on the play. And Nick Saban, like you said, got into trouble when he equated the events of that loss against Louisiana Monroe to some of the calamitous events in our nation's history, all on 9/11 and Pearl Harbor.
Yeah, he called them catastrophic in comparing
them. No foul on the play. The play was ruled uncatchable.
That's a good call right there. That was an uncatchable ball. And I think the point is that was all overrated. We understand the point Nick Saban was trying to make. But the more valid point is when you coach at a place like Alabama, everything you say is going to be dissected. And the reality is, Mark, if some other coaches at some other places would have made that statement, it probably would have gone unnoticed. But when you're the head coach at Alabama and you have those hour-long press conferences, sometimes you can say too much now.
2nd and 10, a little pressure coming. The pass complete to DJ Hall. And DJ is spinning his magic on that play.
Boy, give John Parker Wilson credit, Mark. He stepped up and threw a bullet right there on the slant route. That was a big confidence builder for the quarterback.
20 yards.
Well, it's just a little slant route. Good protection. Steps up and throws the football. Really, they're in zone coverage, too deep right there, and that slant's always a good play because the corner has outside technique and leverage.
1st down and 10 as a result at the 41-yard line. Coffey the lone back. 2 tight end formation for the Crimson Tide. And Coffey stopped up after a gain of about 1. And Hall, meanwhile, broke the single-season record for Alabama on that last catch. He now has 66 receptions. What a season it has been for DJ Hall, who earlier this year surpassed the legendary Ozzie Newsome for team receptions.
Markham, he started 41 games, 13 catches against Tennessee, 11 catches against Ole Miss. I think he's underrated nationally, DJ Hall.
He wasn't put on the preseason all-conference team, and that was big motivation for him. Downfield, Wilson incomplete. That was intended for Keith Brown. Sets up a 3rd down and 9, and he's 4th all-time, DJ Hall is now,
in the SEC in receiving yards.
You know what his real name is? Martinez D. Hall.
Where did the J come from?
I have no idea.
That's just a street cred deal, I guess.
But it's Martinez.
He plays well in Tuscaloosa, whatever you want to call him. 9:27 to go, third down and 9. Buffaloes could probably use themselves a good stop right here.
Like, yeah, they're blitzing him too.
They come after Wilson, backside pressure, and they get to him back at the 48-yard line. Ryan Walters with the blitz and the sack for the Buffaloes. And that's going to set up a fourth down now for Alabama. They dialed up a little bit of heat, and it paid off for
it. Yeah, Mark, Ryan Walters comes from the safety blitz from the backside. Look how late he comes. Great effort, and boy, a great job of trying to strip that football out of there. Good job by John Parker Wilson, Mark, of protecting that ball. But the third down woes for Alabama continue. Big stop by Colorado.
Fourth down and 17. P.J. Fitzgerald will punt from his own 39-yard line. And that's Chase McBride you saw standing on his own 10-yard line for Colorado. Alabama has not scored since the latter part of, actually the middle part of the second quarter. That was a moonshot that goes into the end zone. And it'll come out to the 20-yard line, a 49-yard punt, but a net of just 29. And our man Chase McBride having a rough night. Now John with the officials.
Did he signal for a fair?
Shreveport, Louisiana, aglow at night. Alabama leading Colorado 27-17. Buffalo's first down and 10 from their own 20-yard line after that punt. Handoff goes to Hugh Charles, and Charles got maybe two on the play. Well, this could prove to be a defining moment for the quarterback of this team, Cody Hawkins, a young man that was really raised in the shadows of athletics the entire time. Actually, you go back to his early athletic career, and interesting that Bill Buckner, the former Red Sox great, first baseman, was Cody's early baseball coach. And his dad says that Buckner had a great effect on Cody's confidence as a young athlete, believing in Cody. But he was a pitcher back in the day, and has continued slinging it up until now, Bob.
Well, it's been fun to watch him develop, Mark. We had him earlier against Kansas State. He's come a long way. Yeah. And you can see just how important.
Oh, and it's intercepted. Picked off on the tip. A great play by Darren Mustin to tip it, to make the catch, and then, boy, Brandon Dedrick. Yeah, was Mark, the one that started it all.
Yeah, looked like Ezekiel Knight, I thought, 47, had the initial pressure up the middle right here. Yeah, right there is Ezekiel Knight. Then the ball is tipped right there.
Dedrick made the play to get a hand up by.
And then the interception by Darren Mustin, the senior linebacker.
First down and 10, working with a short field now, Alabama is, in the 22-yard line. Wilson, they fumble the exchange, and all the way back at the 33-yard line is where Stover recovers it.
Wow.
They get back a bunch of yards, and right now really on the fringes of field goal range.
Mark, you are right. I mean, so many times after a turnover, just poor mechanics right there by Stover. Accepting the football, he never created a pocket at all. But again, that's a wide receiver coming on the reverse. But so many times after a turnover, you try to get that big play and get a little bit greedy. But I mean, if it works, it's a great call. But that was poor mechanics right there.
They lose 10 yards on the play. Upchurch the lone back, a three receiver formation for Alabama. They give it to Roy Upchurch over the left side of that offensive line. In behind Andre Smith, big number 71. And Upchurch makes it down to the 23-yard line. Seen a lot of Upchurch and Coffee, but no Terry Grant tonight. Grant is actually Alabama's leading rusher on the season with close to 1,000 yards. He made all freshmen this year. But no play, no run from him. Third down and 11 coming up for the Crimson Tide from the 23. Get down to about the 12-yard line for the first down. The Buffaloes came with a blitz last time on third down. Wilson delivers a strike complete. First down just inside the 12-yard line to the guy that's been making clutch plays on not only offense but special teams tonight, Cadell.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, really, you're going to watch Cadell just run to the flat right here. I mean, that's poor, poor coverage right there, though, actually. And when you give up the flat or that width area of the field, that's like stealing right there. I mean, that's the quarterback's first read, just to throw the ball out in the flat. That was too easy right there.
Cadell, four catches, 76 yards, including a touchdown. And was a big part of a blocked punt against Colorado in the first half. Backs lining up out of the eye. Huber and Upchurch in the eye. It's Upchurch on the old ISO and lead play, and that's when you get some real hat-to-hat action.
Yeah, Mark, that was a good lick right there. Jordan Dizon coming across and making the tackle, but I was just about ready to make the point about Cody Hawkins, how far he has developed,
right,
and how important it is to get in a bowl game for a young guy like that, to have the extra practice, play the extra game, and then the big turnover for Colorado.
That was a bad start to the night for Cody Hawkins, who threw an interception on the first play of the game for Colorado offensively. Second and goal coming up, meanwhile, for Alabama.
Big series for the Colorado defense, Mark, just to hold them to a field goal opportunity right here.
Wilson hands it off to Upchurch. He's going to be stopped up for a loss of about two. Nice play, good penetration that time by Brad Jones, the 6'3 junior. And it'll be third and goal coming up for Alabama.
And I'll tell you who's had a great night, Mark. The nose guard, Brandon Nicholas, the transfer from Notre Dame. Look at him stone the center in there. He has really played an outstanding game. Not a lot of plays from George Hippolyte, the other defensive tackle tonight, but Brandon Nicholas, a great football game inside.
On third and goal now for the Tide. Wilson, and he throws this one away. Fourth and goal coming up, the Buffalo defense holding.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, that was a huge stop, because you keep it to a 30-17 football game. And that's a win for the Colorado defense, no question, after the big turnover.
And a turnover that gave Alabama a very short field to work with offensively. This field goal attempt going to come from about 25 yards out.
Tiffin missed one against Auburn, Mark. He also had one blocked against UL Monroe.
They call it 26. And you can just call it good. And Tiffin now has set an Alabama school record for field goals with that good field goal. Back with more from Shreveport. It's 30-17 for the Tide. Well, that last field goal by Alabama, their first points of the second half, courtesy of a 26-yard field goal from Lee Tiffin. 4:36 to go. One of these teams is going to end up over the old Mendoza line. The other one's going to end up at 6-7. At the 7-yard line, Hugh Charles. And Charles takes it out close to the 30, just a little bit beyond. Well, we have seen some indelible images tonight, and here's our sharp Aquos HD image of the game. It goes back to Chase McBride. What in the name of Jose Canseco is going on with that header?
Yeah, a bit of a soccer background.
Well, it reminds me of Jose Canseco when he had that baseball go off the top of his noggin over the fence for a home run. Yeah. Colorado at least picked up a little extra yardage, yeah, from that.
You never know what you're going to find. That's like the Arizona State-Texas game in the holiday when Max's stepson came out on the field. Although the stepson wasn't the only one out on that field.
No, there were a lot of people.
There were a couple other administrative guys that were farther out there, almost to the hash mark. But the stepson got all the heat.
Hawkins pulls the trigger complete. DeVray has been a huge part of their offense tonight, and he got hit when he made the catch. Boy, you got to be a big fan of DeVray tonight.
No question, Mark. And he is going to run right down the seam. The linebacker got picked a little bit by the umpire. But, yeah, I mean, that was a good hit coming across there by Marcus Carter right there. And he's sandwiched by Kareem Jackson.
Eight catches tonight for DeVray, a total of 81 yards, including the touchdown. Hawkins going up top on this one, has a man, and it's caught by Patrick Williams. Hey, 4:10 to go, plenty of time for the Buffaloes. He was working against Lionel Mitchell defensively.
Yeah, Mark, again, it's just one-on-one on the outside, and anytime you're man-to-man, the ball underthrown a little bit, that was a great adjustment to the football by the receiver, and the advantage the receiver has, he has his eyes back to that ball the whole way, so he can adjust to the underthrown ball.
See what they do here on first down and 10 from the 14.
I tell you, they can throw the football vertically now, and you have to be impressed with Cody Hawkins, Mark.
Bounce back on that last delivery. Into the end zone.
Oh,
incomplete. As Josh Smith seemed to have it, but he had to turn around and twist around to even make a play on the ball. Tough catch.
Yeah, Mark, it was again. Lionel Mitchell matched up on Josh Smith. Excellent coverage, but again, the ball thrown to the opposite shoulder. Great body control. Lionel Mitchell almost tipped that ball into Josh Smith's arms right there.
Sets up second down and 10 under the lights here at Independence Stadium. It's the Petro Sun Independence Bowl in Alabama out of the SEC against the Big 12's Colorado Buffaloes. And Mark Jones along with Bob Davies. Stacy Dale's down in the field. 4:04 to go. Cody Hawkins trying to bring his team back. Is that picked off? Waiting for a call. And it's going to be ruled incomplete. But boy, Rashad Johnson shows you why he led this team with 6 interceptions. That was tops in the conference, too.
Yeah, Mark, first team All-SEC. That is a tremendous athletic play by Rashad Johnson. I mean, the coaches love this guy now. Was a walk-on at Alabama. That was athletic.
Sure was. Has 13 tackles, by the way, Bob, in the game tonight, too. Here we go on third down and 10. Hawkins, complete and touchdown. DeVray again, his second touchdown catch of the night. And it's down to just a 7-point lead with the extra point to follow and 3:51 to go. The Buffaloes still with 2 timeouts remaining. Hold on.
And Mark, it starts. Watch the block by Byron Ellis right here. And Colorado's done a good job blocking these blitzes. Right there, he chops the linebacker. And how about the throw by Cody Hawkins?
14-yard play and the touchdown. And now just a 6-point lead.
Colorado holding Alabama to that field goal on that last possession was huge. But boy, the Big 12 North now, you talk about some explosive offenses. This is just a freshman quarterback at Colorado. All of a sudden, the Big 12 North, Mark.
Well, Capital One Bowl Week featuring over 20 bowl games in 12 days on the ESPN Family Networks continues with 2 evening games on New Year's Eve. On ESPN at 4 Eastern, Kentucky faces Bobby Bowden and his Florida State Seminoles. And Clemson taking on Auburn Monday amongst the other matchups. There's a look at the deal on Clemson and Auburn.
Yeah, Clemson with that big win over South Carolina late in the season. Boy, you have to be impressed with the resiliency of Colorado. And Dan Hawkins.
Hey, what do we do here now, Bob? 2 timeouts remaining for the Buffaloes.
Oh, you kick it, Mark. Kick the ball deep, play defense, and get it back. You can see it doesn't take Colorado long to score.
Just 45 seconds.
When they
on
get
that
it going
drive.
Now. The problem is Arenas, this returner for Alabama, is a dynamic runner now.
Yeah, he ran back up to the Auburn game with an ankle injury, but look. From the 8-yard line, and we talked about his prowess in special teams. There's the evidence of it right there. A huge, huge return when you look at taking them downfield at least a little bit, but there's a flag on the play.
Boy, Mark, this is a big call. And Arenas, just a sophomore, is he an electrifying returner? He missed the Auburn game, as you mentioned, with that high ankle sprain.
See what this call is about.
Looks like holding.
During the return, holding. Return team number 10.
Boy,
10 yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Alabama retains possession.
And you know, Mark, Alabama only 11 penalties in their last four games. Right there, number 10. Yeah, grabs that jersey a little bit, no question, but the least penalized team in the SEC, Alabama, only 55 penalties in 12 games. But the unbelievable stat, 11 penalties only in the last four games.
Wow.
That's less than three a game, but they lost all four games, which is amazing.
Sometimes you see some of the most heavily penalized teams are some of the more successful teams
exactly.
in football. Wilson fires complete to DJ Hall. Hall stays in bounds. About 3 yards short of the first down, the team's leading receiver. And Colorado is going to burn one of their two remaining timeouts. With 3:35 to go, Hall with four catches for 58 yards tonight.
Yeah, Major Applewhite showing a lot of confidence right there. And John Parker Wilson throwing the football on first and 10. Sets up a second and short. But you look at Dan Hawkins, there's Major Applewhite. Right there. I remember when he played at Texas, obviously, but getting back to Dan Hawkins in Colorado, they always play a very difficult schedule at Colorado because they're in a town where you have to play big time teams, Mark, to attract attendance. Next year, West Virginia and Florida State on the schedule non-conference for Dan Hawkins.
Here we go. Alabama looking at second down and two. Alabama trying to hang on to the football. Run out some clock. And a first down by Roy Upchurch. Getting back to Hawkins, you know, he's not afraid to speak his mind. We've heard several of his rants, one of them regarding one of the parents calling him up and complaining about the amount of time that players have had to spend at Colorado. Another one of his great ones was sitting at 0-5 a couple of years ago in his first year. He says to a group of fans at a pep rally, "Our worst days as a Buffalo are better than the best days as a Cornhusker." Yeah. The Nebraska people got a hold of it, but you have to admire a coach like Dan Hawkins securing himself to be able to say something like that.
Well, he did the intramurals and then Gundy at Oklahoma State with "I'm a man, I'm 40.
The quote of the year.
Getting some quotes coming out of that league now.
Upchurch makes the play, and Colorado is going to burn its final timeout with 3 minutes to go in the ball game. It has been a furious comeback by Colorado here in the second half of play. It actually started towards the latter half of the second quarter. At one point, Dan Hawkins right there, his team reeling off 17 consecutive points to rally from a 27-point deficit. Let's check in downstairs with Stacey Dales.
Just a little tidbit to add for you and Bob, Mark. Lest we forget that the Christmas gift was a samurai sword. That's right, a samurai sword, guys. Cody went to the mall in Boulder and got his dad a sword. I guess that personifies some of the strength you're talking about.
Well, you know, another deal, he has a staff wellness challenge, set up a scoring system with the coaches on weight loss, cardio, strength, so they don't burn out.
Wow.
We may do that next year if we're together, but, you know, Stacy's going to win it anyway.
Should do some work on that treadmill. Wilson, boy, that was dangerously close to being picked off by number 42, Benjamin Burney. Third down and 7 coming up. Burney and Hall jaw-jacking a little.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, just bump and run, man-to-man coverage.
Wow.
It's good no-call. It sets up a third and crucial down right now. Colorado right there, you see, with no timeouts. Does Alabama run the football here, Mark, and just use clock? Or do they have confidence in John Parker Wilson to throw the football?
Well, they got to get right around the 49 to get the first down.
I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah, I was going to say run the draw, but I was wrong.
Wilson, he's going to take off himself, and he got the first down. It's going to be marked way on the other side of midfield, and that might be the ball game. Colorado with no timeouts remaining.
Yeah, Mark, I mean, that is a big play. I mean, this guy's a baseball player. Thought about playing baseball at Alabama. Colorado loses contain. and a huge third down conversion for John Parker Wilson.
19 of 33 today with the three touchdown passes. Started off with a real hot hand.
And Mark, Alabama's going to use the clock. They can't take a knee. They need to go ahead and run the football, even though Colorado is out of timeouts right here.
First down and 10. A busted play, and Wilson is going to fall down for a loss of about one. John Parker Wilson and Alabama looking for their seventh win of the season, and Nick Saban's crew looking for its first win since October the 20th against Tennessee.
Yeah, Mark, only 10 seniors on their top 44 2D, plus their punter and kicker back. They are a young football team, Alabama.
Rebuilding in the SEC is a different type of deal.
No, you've got that right there now.
There aren't that many breathers on the schedule. Second and 12. Upchurch again. And Upchurch going to be stopped up for a gain of about one on the play. Colorado trying to rip that ball loose with no timeouts remaining. Don't forget, coming up next at SportsCenter, the recap of a busy day in sports. And this is the great part about the season, Bob, is all the bowl games we get a chance to call and watch at this time of the year. Capital One Bowl Week continuing in the upcoming days. And at this time, I want to say season's greetings, partner, to you and to Stacy down in the field.
Well, I appreciate that. How about our guys in the truck?
Yeah.
Phil Dean, Kelly Atkinson, Bonnie Riley, Turtle.
Turtle.
All our guys, just a tremendous job.
Wayne Edwards as well, Steve LeBeau, our stat man, Seth Jacobson, our spotter.
How about Darryl Green sending out all those articles to us every week so you can get all your little nuggets?
Sack made on the play by Jones on Upchurch, 46 seconds to go.
Mark, obviously, when they set this football ready for play right here is crucial.
Fourth down coming up.
Looks like there's going to be about 10 seconds left.
This might set up the stage, Bob, for some, some crazy laterals coming up here on the punt.
Could be.
And the ensuing offensive play if they get a couple off.
Alabama probably run it down to 1 second.
19 seconds to go. Colorado helpless to stop it. Watch it wind down to 12 seconds. And Alabama calls one of its three remaining timeouts. Capital One Bowl Week featuring over 20 bowl games in 12 days on ESPN's Family Networks, continuing with two afternoon games on the eve of a new year. First, at 12:30 Eastern on ESPN, Cal faces Air Force in the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl. Then at 2 Eastern on ESPN2, Georgia Tech takes on Fresno State in the Rhodes Humanitarian Bowl. And I want to send a shout out to Hugh and Marjorie Jones in Toronto, Canada, two rabid, ravenous college football fans. My dad's happy about the fact that Joe Pa got a big win yesterday. He's part of that 80-year-old club, you know, so he roots for his peers.
How about this guy here? That's a bright future, Cody Hawkins. They have some young speed coming in at wide receiver, Mark. They're going to be a force to be reckoned with in the Big 12 now.
Well, you talk about their improvement from a season ago at 2-10 to where they are now.
Alabama with one punt block this season.
A high snap. Fitzgerald is going to watch this one bounce. Is it going to be down? Oh, it travels into the end zone. They'll come out to the 20-yard line with all of 1 second to go.
And here comes your famous lateral exhibition right here. Yeah. Now, was it Millsaps College? It was one of the plays of the year.
You know what? You're right. I think it was.
Yeah, I think it was.
Trinity?
Trinity versus Millsaps,
yeah.
Right? We may see that right here. And you know, Hawk, a guy that Mongolian food.
They might practice this
samurai
every day.
Sword, the whole deal. He has to have something creative,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Now,
I'll be disappointed
from Trinity and Millsaps. He's going to have something. Look.
Ordering up the Hawk special, the Mongolian special.
Watch this now. This is going to have some unique twist right here to it, Mark Jones.
You can draw up maybe, what, two or three laterals, and then after that, you're on your own.
This is where the creativity of the players comes in.
And if they don't lateral it at least two or three times, I'm going to be very disappointed.
And it's never easy. I promise you, Nick Saban right now, his stomach is still in knots.
Looking for a Cal Stanford-type miracle here.
Oh, come on, Hawk.
That's about as basic.
There it is.
Oh, he got it off in time. There's
there
one, two. Was that forward? They throw it back. It's still alive.
Look out. That's it.
And that is the end. The very end.
He gave us a little something, though,
yeah,
didn't he?
Yeah. Pass down the middle, then the lateral. And the Alabama Crimson Tide improved to 7-6 with the win.
And Shreveport looks a lot better to Alabama this year, Mark, than it did a year ago when they lost,
It'll
right?
It'll be a much more pleasant five-hour drive down Interstate 20 for Nick Saban's followers as Alabama wins it 30-24. And Coach Hawkins not going quietly into the new year. Simeon Castile and his teammates with a strong first half showing and riding that momentum to a 30-24 win. That's the final score. And coming up next on ESPN, it's SportsCenter. Folks, for more on this game, we'll be on ESPN News in just a moment to wrap things up for you. It's been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, along with Bob Davies, Stacey Dales, and our entire gang. I'm Mark Jones saying good night from Shreveport, and thanks for watching. All the best, folks, in 2008. Right now, here's SportsCenter.